Good afternoon, everyone. The first item of business this afternoon is a debate on motion number 14879 in the name of Paul Wheelhouse on stage one of the Community Justice Scotland Bill. I invite all members who wish to take part in this debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I now call on Minister Paul Wheelhouse to speak to and move the motion. Minister, 14 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to open this stage one debate on the principles of the Community Justice Bill. I thank the convener, Christine Graham, and the Justice Committee for the scrutiny of the bill and for their stage one report. I also thank the Finance Committee and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for their consideration of the bill. And I am pleased that evidence was taken from such a wide range of organisations and individuals. I welcome the committee's endorsement for the need to improve community justice structures and its broad support for the general principles of the bill. The committee made a number of detailed recommendations in its report, and the government will respond to these in January. In this afternoon's debate, I will address some of the more significant points that the committee raised, and I will also focus on the principles of the bill and the positive changes it will bring for community justice in Scotland. Presiding Officer, this is an important period for community justice in Scotland. We have made clear the Scottish Government's commitment to reduce reoffending and the harm it causes to individuals, families and communities. That commitment sits within our broader vision for a fairer justice system in Scotland, a vision which reflects the values of a modern and progressive nation in which prison, and in particular short-term sentences, are used less frequently. And where there is a stronger emphasis on robust community sentences focused on actively addressing the underlying causes of offending behaviour. It's important that individuals are held to account for the offences they have committed, but thereafter are supported to be responsible contributors to our communities. The new model for community justice supports this vision by delivering better outcomes for communities through reducing reoffending and supporting desistance. In demonstrating these better outcomes, the new model supports the increased use of effective community sentences, the reduced use of short prison sentences, and the improved reintegration of people who have offended back into their communities. Since 2012, we've worked closely with our stakeholders to design a new model for community justice which delivers a community solution to achieving improved outcomes, preventing and reducing further offending and supporting desistance. And the Community Justice Bill provides a legislative framework for that new model. Presiding Officer, I think it's important for members to note that the new model places decision-making locally with those who know their communities best, understand problems that are unique to their area and will be most affected by community justice issues that relate to both victims and people with a history of offending. However, for those including committee members who wish to see a strong direction at national level, local planning, delivery and collaboration will be complemented by arrangements at national level which provide profile, leadership and strategic direction for the sector. And let me provide a little more detail. The strategic planning and delivery of community justice services will take place at a local level. Duties will be placed on local statutory partners to engage with communities and the third sector to identify the key priorities for the local area and plan for these. These local arrangements will be complemented by leadership at a national level on a parity with that provided for the custodial sector. A new public body named Community Justice Scotland will provide that leadership, working closely with community justice partners, the third sector and a range of other parties. Community Justice Scotland will also generate enhanced opportunities for innovation, learning and development and provide independent professional assurance to Scottish ministers and local authority leaders on the collective achievement of community justice outcomes across Scotland, including improvement support where required. The national strategy will provide a vision for community justice in Scotland. It will help partners to prioritise key areas which they will address in partnership through an approach which is both outcomes focused and evidence based. And in this way, the strategy will facilitate and drive improvement. A set of common outcomes will be agreed to ensure that we are working together to achieve what the evidence tells us will reduce the chance of a person reoffending. And this will also bring transparency and clarity to our progress in delivering improved results across Scotland, thereby supporting the increased use of community sentences and diversion activity. Bringing all of these elements together, the new model presents a more holistic and collaborative approach to the community justice system, which will be driven forward at both local and national level by the common aim of securing better outcomes for people and communities across Scotland. So let me now turn to some of the points raised by the Justice Committee in its Stage 1 report. The definition of community justice in the bill has drawn a lot of comment from stakeholders and indeed the committee, and I do understand why there were calls for the definition to be broadened to include early intervention and the prevention of first-time offending. Clearly, it is important to stop people entering the criminal justice system in the first place, and that is why the government has a clear focus on advancing the whole system approach and improving life chances. The drive in community justice to reduce reoffending is part of our wider approach to promoting social justice and tackling inequality, which includes action to improve early years experiences, to raise educational attainment for all, and to continue to promote the whole system's approach to youth justice. A range of other policies are addressing the underlying causes of offending, such as homelessness, poverty, and drugs misuse. The new national strategy for community justice will link with these other strategies to ensure a joined-up approach. And I am pleased that the committee has noted the Scottish Government's position on this. That said, I do recognise that definition could be strengthened further, and I will explore with stakeholders the possibility of reflecting, for example, the preventative impact of diversionary activity in the definition. After all, evidence does show that diverting individuals away from the criminal justice system is an effective way of preventing further offending. There was much discussion at the committee hearings about the cluttered landscape of community justice, and the committee acknowledges that community justice is a complex area which requires the provision of a diverse range of services in order to respond to the often complex needs of people with a history of offending. And that is why in this bill we are providing for a multi-agency collaborative approach to improving community justice outcomes for our communities. I will go further by saying that the new model brings coherence to that cluttered landscape by providing for strategic direction, strong leadership and a collaborative approach to planning, reporting and commissioning of services. The Justice Committee has requested further clarity on the roles and responsibilities of those involved in the new model to ensure effective interaction. Presiding Officer, I believe this bill makes clear who the community justice partners are, what they are required to do and whom they must involve. Crucially, it also sets out a participative role for communities and the third sector. It also defines the role of Community Justice Scotland and confirms how and when Scottish ministers may be engaged. The key relationships are therefore articulated in the bill. The transition work that we are currently undertaking with our partners and stakeholders will provide further opportunities to be clear about roles and relationships going forward, and this will help community justice partners prepare for their roles and understand key processes. We are working with our partners and stakeholders to prepare guidance to aid wider understanding. The National Strategy for Community Justice is vital in setting the high-level priorities and strategic direction. I would like to clarify that it is currently being developed with stakeholders. Indeed, a number of events have been organised across Scotland, including around 400 partners and stakeholders to date, including the third sector, people with convictions, community planning partners and MSPs. Additional sessions will be held to ensure we capture the views of the general public, victims of crime, people with convictions and indeed their families. I expect the National Strategy to be published in June 2016. Presiding Officer, I note the committee's concern that the outcomes for community justice should be framed more broadly so that reoffending rates are not the only measure of success. And I'd like to reassure the committee and indeed the Chamber on this point. We're currently developing the national outcomes for community justice with partners and stakeholders. The outcomes and associated indicators will be used by the statutory community justice partners to plan services, measure progress, report on achievements and identify any issues. Therefore, outcomes are vital in enabling the new model to demonstrate improvements in community justice in a transparent and consistent way. And there will also be of great value to the Community Justice Scotland in its role driving forward the national strategy. And the outcomes are currently in draft and are being tested in specific local areas. The draft outcomes will fall into two categories. Structural outcomes, which include, for example, improved public understanding, participation and confidence in community sentencing, and person-centric outcomes, which include greater equality of access to services for people with a history of offending. There is a strong correlation between equality of access to key universal services and a lowered risk of reoffending, and that is why access to key universal services such as housing, employment, education and health services are represented in the draft outcomes. I hope this provides reassurance that a truly holistic approach is being taken to the setting of common outcomes. And staying on the subject of planning, the committee has identified some confusion over how community justice planning links with wider community planning and community planning partners. The bill requires the 8 statutory community justice partners to engage, plan and report collectively. Community planning partnerships are not mentioned in the bill because they are not statutory entities, rather they are the sum of their partners and we cannot therefore assign duties directly to them. However, the Scottish Government has always set the planning for community justice within the context of wider community planning. Indeed, 6 of the 8 community justice partners are also community planning partners. The collective knowledge of CPPs supports the multi-agency holistic approach to reducing reoffending, which is at the heart of the new model. And we therefore expect community planning partnerships to be at the core of the new model and community justice planning to take place using community planning structures. And this will ensure alignment of planning activity. The transition work, which is already underway, will help community planning partnerships and community justice partners to consider the sort of relationship they want and to build that relationship. A number of areas are already formulating plans to collaborate with CPPs, including Fife, Highland and Perth and Kinross. Of course, with effective planning comes effective monitoring and accountability, and I thank the committee for drawing attention to the importance of accountability arrangements and the role of Community Justice Scotland, so let me be clear about that as well. Local leadership and ownership of community justice are absolutely vital to the success of the new arrangements. That is why we are respecting the existing lines of accountability for the statutory community justice partners so that they are not accountable to Community Justice Scotland. The responsibility for resolving any local issues with planning of or the quality of delivery rests with the local statutory community justice partners. Should partners request assistance on issues that they have not been able to resolve locally, then of course Community Justice Scotland can offer support and advice. However, should an annual report indicate a persistent issue, then Community Justice Scotland could make recommendations to Scottish ministers. The bill does not specify what the recommendations might be, as this is a matter for Community Justice Scotland to propose and for Scottish ministers to determine what action to take at that time should the need arise. But I anticipate that recommendations could include the need for an improvement plan, the need for formal inspection. In exceptional circumstances, there could be a recommendation to establish a rescue task group. And these arrangements will be reflected in guidance in due course. Finally, I'd like to recognise the important role of the third sector in community justice. The third sector, including victims' organisations, is vital to the successful planning and delivery of effective services for individuals. The sector has made a long-standing contribution to the delivery of outcomes for community justice at local and national levels. The committee highlights concerns around the nature of their participation in community justice, as currently provided for in the bill, and I do understand those concerns. I have listened to the committee's concerns and to the concerns of the third sector, and I am now seeking to amend the bill to strengthen their role and participation, and I hope I will be in a position to be clear on the how of that in the near future. Presiding Officer, as the committee recognised, any new model for community justice must achieve an appropriate balance between strong national leadership to drive forward improvement in outcomes and local flexibility in relation to the delivery of services. I believe that the new model which is being proposed through the bill strikes the right balance. It will deliver a community solution to improved outcomes for community justice, to reducing reoffending and to supporting desistance. And therefore, this is first and foremost a local model. We do recognise that local areas are best placed to determine the outcomes that are the priority in their local area and the activities required to achieve those outcomes. These arrangements will be complemented by Community Justice Scotland working with local partners to provide leadership at a national level, to promote innovation and learning, and to provide assurance that outcomes are being delivered, and to highlight any concerns regarding local delivery to ministers. I look forward to working with members of all parties and stakeholders to secure these objectives as the bill continues through Parliament. So, Presiding Officer, I now move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Christine Graham to speak on behalf of the Justice Committee. 10 minutes are thereby, please, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak on behalf of the Justice Committee who led the consideration of the bill at stage one. I thank all who submitted evidence, gave evidence, our clerks, and of course, as always, my diligent and hard-working committee. Although I always find it odd, and I'm going to say this again on the record, Deputy Presiding Officer, that I speak to the report after the ministers responded to it. Seems to me that's the cart before the horse. But there we are. We must change these rules at some point. So the statement is made by the committee, the minister responds, and on we go. Perhaps not relevant, but it really seems daft. I'm going to be saying things that have already been responded to. But there we go. Now, the topic might seem as dry as dust, but this legislation deals with how we set up systems, how we organise at a national and local level support to prevent reoffending, which costs the public purse an arm and a leg, fails society in the first place, individuals and their families. As the current arrangements for community justice only came into being in 2007, some might question whether the wholesale change provided for in the bill is premature. However, In two separate reports in 2012, the Commission on Women Offenders and Audit Scotland both identified significant problems with current structures, the number of bodies involved, accountability, funding mechanisms, and the complexity of the arrangements. That seems an awful lot, which they argued were inhibiting the potential to reduce reoffending. Throughout its Stage 1 scrutiny, the committee has been keen to establish whether legislative reform is needed, and if so, whether what's contained within the bill could achieve the change envisioned by the above parties. We took evidence over three meetings, hearing from a range of local authority bodies and partnerships, third sector, victims groups, the Commission on Women Offenders, the SPS, Police Scotland and Audit Scotland. And I'd like to thank, as I've said, everybody took the effort to respond and give evidence. The committee broadly supports the general principles of the bill, but we made a number of recommendations aimed in particular at strengthening strategic leadership, accountability, I don't know what this word means, demystifying the complex landscape, which mystifies me. I think it means making it understandable and workable. That I'm being given definitions. Many who responded to our call for evidence were concerned that the definition of community justice used in the bill was too narrow and differs substantially from that used in the government's earlier consultation. The committee was particularly sympathetic, as the minister knows, the view that prevention and early intervention should not only be reflected in the definition, but elsewhere in the bill. And I note the minister's comments in this regard, and I think the committee would welcome that. We appreciate that these measures will be taken forward through other policies, but we did feel that if you're going to try to do the right thing, save money and save wasted lives, you might get in early rather than wait till somebody's offended. Back in 2012, the Commission on Women Offenders described the community justice system as, quotes, grossly cluttered landscape, another phrase I don't like, close quotes. On the basis of the evidence received, the committee still has some doubts as to whether the new arrangements set in place in the bill, will simplify this, as community justice, as the Minister has said, relies on a diverse range of service providers working in partnership, and we believe that more could be done to streamline these arrangements by setting out clearer roles and responsibilities. We drew the Minister's attention to the concerns raised by members in particular of the third sector and those with small voluntary bodies who have to operate with minimal staff and a limited budget. At present, these organisations deal with 8 community justice authorities, but under the model set out in the bill, this number would increase fourfold to 32 local authorities. This is likely to put significant pressure on them to raise funding as providers, which is already under strain and therefore would impact on local services, often very well tailored to that area. As we all know, many of the organisations that make up the community justice system rely on this short-term funding. And we are disappointed that the same concerns about the funding and sustainability of third sector projects has persisted over decades. We do, however, welcome the Scottish Government's current review of the funding mechanism for community justice social work services, which is due to report shortly, and we'd welcome early sight of this report. Minister, if you can make headway with regard to the funding for the voluntary sector, that would be very much welcomed by the committee, but more importantly, by the voluntary sector. A lack of strategic vision was one of the major issues highlighted by the Commission on Women Offenders and Audit Scotland. The committee therefore welcomes the provisions in the bill requiring Scottish ministers to develop a national strategy which should allow for a clearer strategic direction and improved oversight. But there were differing views among witnesses regarding the level of oversight the national body should have, with local authority bodies preferring a light touch approach, and others, including Dame Eilish Angelini, chair of the former Commission on Women Offenders, supportive of local bodies being more accountable to Community Justice Scotland. We remain concerned that without adequate powers to measure and bring forward improvements, weaknesses which this bill seeks to overcome may persist. But we welcome the provisions contained within the bill to introduce a national performance framework. This should help to ensure that the success of the model proposed in the bill can be adequately measured and any problems can be identified. However, we consider it vital that stakeholders are fully involved in the development of the strategy and framework. I think the Minister did say they're busy doing that already, which is to be welcomed. We will notice the Government's intention to publish a national strategy and framework in the middle of next year, and we would request early sight of these documents to ensure they are fit for purpose. Under the bill, community justice partners would be responsible for the local planning, delivery and monitoring of community justice services. Some witnesses felt that the bill should specify a lead partner within each community justice partnership, While the committee considers there may be merit in appointing a lead partner to ensure a focus, we would be wary of this leading to other partners avoiding their responsibilities. The committee therefore does not support a specific requirement in the bill that a lead partner should be appointed. Instead, we recommend that partnerships have the flexibility to appoint a lead partner where they consider it to be appropriate to do so. And I think we're sympathetic to at least somebody being in the lead. The bill does not make any reference to community planning partnerships. However, the policy memorandum suggests that CPPs should have a key role in planning community justice arrangements. We remain unclear why the bill creates a new level of partnerships rather than placing responsibility for community justice planning with CPPs, though I heard the Minister had to say it with the statutory status of the two. The committee is of the view that any new system for community justice must achieve an appropriate balance between strong national leadership to ensure improvements in performance and local flexibility in relation to the delivery of services. It is a balance. It's a difficult balance, but it's important. As such, the committee sees merit in the general approach taken in the bill. However, we have concern that the detailed proposal in the bill may not achieve that correct balance and therefore recommend that the oversight functions of the national body are strengthened to provide the robust leadership and accountability found to be lacking currently. In general, the evidence we received did not show any great enthusiasm for one system with which all bodies involved in community justice would be wholly satisfied. The committee recognises, however, that this is enabling legislation and that the detail of how the arrangements are to work in practice would be set out in the National Strategy, National Performance Framework and Guidance, and that the success of the bill will, to some extent, be evident once it's in operation. So I look forward to hearing from other members' contributions in the debate, and we'll touch on issues I've not raised, and to receiving the Scottish Government's response, which I think I've just heard, to our Stage 1 report. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Dr. Elaine Murray, 10 minutes or thereby, even a generous 10 minutes, should you wish.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm going to start off by thanking the committee clerks, Spice, and the witnesses who gave both verbal and oral evidence on behalf of the Labour members of the committee. The bill replaces the current system of 8 regional community justice authorities, or CJAs, there's a lot of acronyms in this, with 32 community justice partners, one per local authority, and establishes a national organisation, Community Justice Scotland. Serious concerns had been raised, as Christine Graham said in her speech, about the performance of CJAs in both the Angelini report and Women Offenders, who reported lack of strategic leadership and accountability, short-term funding, inconsistency of services and lack of through care for offenders, and also by Audit Scotland in 2012, which criticised the CJAs as having many organisations involved, no nationally agreed measure of performance, a lack of strong leadership, that statutory partners are not accountable to CJAs and that they had a limited capacity to undertake their full range of work. So it's clear that revision was required. The Scottish Government published a consultation paper in December 2012 with 3 options: an enhanced system of CJAs, a local authority model and a single service model, but there was no consensus around any of them other than a preference for a model which involved local delivery. A further consultation on the model proposed in the bill was undertaken in 2014 and received a generally favourable response. This consultation differed from some of the measures in the bill, particularly in that it proposed that community planning partnerships would be the central to the local delivery of community justice services, and reference has already been made to those differences. Other current policy developments will also interact with the bill. That was one of the questions which the committee had. Indeed, John Finney proposed that maybe we should have some sort of flow diagram or a schematic which showed how all the different initiatives linked together. The implementation, for example, of the Community Empowerment Scotland Act, which places duties on community planning partners to carry out community planning within each local authority area, and the current consultation on the presumption against short-term sentences, which seeks views on whether sentences of 3 months and under should be extended, that the presumption against them should be extended, or whether in fact a more radical review of short-term imprisonment, including remand, is actually required. The government has also been consulting on changes to the configuration of the female prison estate, which I hope, and many of us hope indeed, will also lead to an increase in community over criminal disposals. The bill requires Scottish ministers to publish a national strategy, and the government is currently consulting, as the minister said, on this and the national performance framework. And actually was one of those who attended the strategy consultation day in Dumfries. And I believe in giving congratulations where they are due, because I thought it was a very good example of local engagement, and I found it very informative. And the feeling I got from the other participants was that they also appreciated the opportunity to contribute to the discussion of what should be in the national strategy and the performance framework. As the bill is enabling, and details of how it will work in practice will be set out in the national strategy and performance framework and the associated guidance, it's important that we have that sort of local engagement. Witnesses to the committee in general agreed that improvements are required to the current community justice arrangements, although I have to say the CJA conveners disagreed. However, there are still questions about whether the bill achieves the correct balance between national leadership and local flexibility. As the convener has already stated, the definition of community justice is much narrower than that on the 2014 consultation on a future model for community justice. It no longer refers to the prevention of offending and is restricted to people who have already offended. This change was not consulted on, and there is no explanation in the policy memorandum as to why the definition changed. We in these benches agree with the majority of witnesses on the committee who were of the opinion that the definition should already also include desistance, prevention and early intervention, and I'm pleased to hear that the Minister is considering amendments along those lines. Some witnesses also objected to the use of the term offender, considering that to be stigmatising. Indeed, this was discussed at one of the events I was at. I think the problem is, what else do you use? The offending may have a stigma attached to it. It's difficult to see how you describe people in a more or a less stigmatised way. Other witnesses were concerned that the bill does not refer to the interests and involvement of victims in particular and the wider community in more general. Community justice alternatives to imprisonment will only be accepted by the general public and by the judiciary when sentencing if they are demonstrated to be effective in keeping the public safe and in changing individuals' offending behaviour. Services such as 218 in Glasgow and Willow in Edinburgh, both supporting women in the criminal justice system, are widely praised. The success of their approach in helping people turn... Yes, indeed.
Mr. Stevenson.
Will the member agree with me that if we fail in rehabilitating people we put in our prisons, we actually reduce community safety and safety for our population, because we return people to the community who are simply going to reoffend and reduce safety?
Absolutely. I mean, that's acknowledged as being one of the problems with the current criminal justice system, that there's this revolving door and people do not change their lives around. I think the importance is that the alternative approaches aren't understood. They're not out there in the public eye. They're not out there in the media. And even the judiciary don't always know that other alternatives are available, where actually are a lot more successful than just banging somebody up for a few weeks. Most witnesses to the committee agreed that the current model was not effective, and they accepted that the community justice landscape was, in quotes, cluttered, which seems to be a very popular word at the moment. Some doubted, as Christine Graham said, that going from 8 CJAs to 32 CPPs plus CJS would actually simplify anything, and this concern was compounded by community justice partnerships now being the vehicle rather than the CPPs. The relationship between the CJPs and CPPs is unclear, and there's a danger of yet another organisational layer when perhaps the CPPs could be the CJPs, and indeed that may well be what happens in practice in many areas. The bill defines statutory community justice partners, which are all public sector agencies, and requires them, in formulating their community justice outcomes and improvement plans, to consult community bodies and other persons, quote, as they consider appropriate, unquote. One consequence of this flexibility could be that third sector organisations might not be included in some community justice partnerships, and that they might only be consulted when the statutory partners saw fit. Another concern was that the capacity of small third sector organisations to engage with several different community justice partnerships if their services were available in more than one area. Although, as we said at the committee, there is nothing in the bill to prevent CPPs working together in geographical areas where that made sense, and hopefully that they will, that sort of model will appear as well. Although you have separate CJPs, you could get CJPs working in partnership across different council areas. The bill does not propose a lead partner with overall responsibility within each CJP to ensure that the improvement plans are driven forward. I understand that ministers are concerned that designation of a lead partner could encourage other partners not to fully engage and leave it up to the lead partner. On the other hand, some others were concerned that the lack of a lead partner with that overall responsibility to drive forward the local plan could actually result in everybody sitting back and nobody taking responsibility. So it's quite a difficult balance to find between the two. The bill proposes several functions for the national organisation, Community Justice Scotland. It must promote the national strategy published by Scottish ministers. It reviews the national performance framework, and it will publish a strategy for innovation, learning and development in relation to community justice matters. It will oversee performance, promote and support improvement, and promote public awareness. Coming back to some of the things I've already been discussing, it will have a role in doing that. And that, again, was discussed at the strategy day I attended, was actually what sort of role could Community Justice Scotland have in ensuring that the public are aware of the successes of other models. CJPs must consult CJS when preparing their local improvement plans, and CJS must monitor their performance in achieving both nationally and locally determined outcomes. Now, some witnesses consider that some form of inspection of CJPs should be introduced, though other witnesses very strongly disagreed. So the committee came to the conclusion overall that this should be the role of Community Justice Scotland and Audit Scotland until the new bodies have time to become established. However, it wasn't certain from the bill what power CJS would have if a CJP failed either to achieve its outcomes set in the plan or failed to consult appropriately with other non-statutory partners. The Minister has given some further assurances in his opening speech on this issue, and I'm sure we will be reflecting on that and whether or not amendment to the bill it will be necessary at stage two in order to reflect the role of Scottish ministers actually in being able to intervene. The boards of the existing CJAs include locally elected councillors, and the CJA conveners expressed concern about losing that input under the new arrangements. So there was some discussion about whether there should be a place or places reserved on Community Justice Scotland for elected member representation, though some considered it might be difficult to identify a councillor or one or two councillor representatives who could speak for all the community justice partnerships across 32 local authority areas. CJS will have a role as a national commissioning body, and striking the correct balance between national commissioning and local flexibility was raised in evidence as a concern. CJS can identify, design an appropriate model and make arrangements for the provision of a community justice service. In doing so, it can encourage, assist or act in collaboration with any of the community justice partners. Community justice partners will, in producing and implementing their plan to improve community justice outcomes in their own areas, be able to purchase services for the nationally commissioned organisations if they are best able to deliver locally, or they can purchase services from local organisations which may provide a service which is more appropriate for the needs of that local area. CJS is to receive 614,000 set-up costs and 2.2 million annual running costs, and the 32 local authorities will share 1.6 million for each of the next 3 years. We are a bit concerned whether this will be sufficient, especially if the desired transfer from the criminal justice disposals to community justice disposals is achieved, and the CJAs are to be active in promoting and providing alternatives to prosecution and in early intervention to support resistance. I know that we would all like to see fewer people in prison, especially serving short sentences, during which little can be achieved in addressing the reasons why the person has become involved in offending behaviour. That will bring in significant savings, but until fewer people are in prison and more people are receiving community justice alternatives, those savings will not be made. And I think that's the nub of the problem, how resources can be transferred from prisons to community justice while there's still a significant prison population. If fewer people are sent to prison, that should free up funding, but there will still, of course, be prison buildings and prison officers. And although the role of prison officers is changing, and they will continue to change more to through care and support for offenders, actually there are problems actually about how we free up the funds to get this started, to get this whole process started. Having said that, I am pleased to say that Scottish Labour members are happy to support stage one of the bill tonight, and we look forward to further discussion of some of the issues to be discussed today at the amendment stages.
Many thanks. I now call on Margaret Mitchell, similarly a generous 6 minutes, Mrs Mitchell.
Yeah. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome this stage one debate on the Community Justice Bill, and thank the many witnesses for their invaluable evidence. I'd also like to thank the committee clerks for their help and assistance in the delivery of this substantial report. In December 2012, the Scottish Government published a three-option consultation on redesigning community justice. This included an enhanced community justice authority model, a local authority model, and a single service model. There was no favoured option, but there was a clear preference for a model with local delivery, partnership and collaboration at its heart, with some form of national arrangements to provide leadership and strategic direction, lacking in the present setup. So by combining the various elements of the earlier options, a fourth option emerged, namely 32 community justice partners and a new national body. However, there's some confusion about how these CGPs will interact with community planning partnerships. Furthermore, it's fair to say other proposals in the bill have not attracted consensus. Concerns remain about the cluttered landscape, with the increase from 8 community justice authorities to now 32 community justice partners. And about leadership, with the balance in decision-making moving heavily towards Community Justice Scotland rather than the local authorities. However, the most controversial aspect of the legislation is the narrow definition of community justice. In the Scottish Government's 2014 consultation on a future model for community justice, the definition was the collection of agencies and services in Scotland that individually and in partnership work to manage offenders, prevent offending, and reduce reoffending, and the harm that it causes to promote social inclusion, citizenship, and desistance. Whereas now, the definition in Section 1 of the Bill no longer refers to the prevention of offending. This failure to make any reference to prevention, or indeed early intervention, represents a major change. Worryingly, in terms of the Justice Committee's scrutiny of the bill, and as Cosla commented, the definition in the bill was not consulted upon and appears to have come as a surprise to stakeholders and, more important, to the statutory partners. Furthermore, it's attracted widespread criticism from the following organisations. Police Scotland. To be successful, it's necessary to take a whole system approach. It needs to be right from start to finish. That leads to the emphasis on prevention and early intervention. Sacral. There is no statement regarding prevention, public safety, or community safety. Turning Point. It is disappointing that the bill does not explicitly direct planning at both national and local levels to consider prevention, especially within the wider context of the community planning process. Bernardo's. If we are to take a truly preventative approach to community justice, we must start at the beginning and focus on how to keep
Microphone, please, for Mrs. Mitchell.
And how to focus to keep people out of the justice system and within their communities. As it stands, the definition is restricted to those who have already offended. Victim Support Scotland, the definition does not allow for a greater focus on prevention and early intervention in line with the recommendations of the Christie Commission. There's also criticism that the bill diminishes the role of the third sector in the planning process, an issue which has been addressed in the Minister's correspondence of 17th of November. Here, in the wider context of resourcing, there are specific references to the third sector. For example, Community Justice Scotland will, with partners and the third sector, develop and agree a strategic approach to commissioning. So while acknowledging the third sector's contribution, it's still evident that if this legislation is passed, then the third sector's role is, like everyone else currently involved in community justice, to deliver the Scottish Government's proposed penal reform agenda to extend the presumption against short-term sentences to up to 1 year. In other words, I'm especially concerned, as are stakeholders, that this bill is a de facto vehicle for the Scottish Government's penal reforms, which, I should add, are currently only at a consultation stage. While the Minister has suggested that the definition requires further consideration at stage two, it is nonetheless deeply worrying that these reforms to community justice have been built on such shaky foundations. In addition to this, these significant changes were made unilaterally, without consultation with the very stakeholders who will, in time, have to implement the bill's provisions. Do I have time for anything else?
Wish.
Yes.
Thank you very much. I thank the member for taking an intervention. I just wanted to point it out. Maybe the reason would be is that the previous legislation was only the definition of the previous legislation was about reducing reoffending. So there were nothing about prevention on the system which operates still today.
Okay, Mitchell.
I'm not quite sure what the point the member is trying to make, but if he's referring to short-term sentences, then I think there's a good bit of analysis requires to be done and will be involved in the consultation currently being undergone, which will look at actually what's been done in prison just now in terms of short-term sentences. And we know there's concrete evidence that these prisoners are given absolutely no access to rehabilitation programmes at present. So that's certainly going to be a factor in penal reform. In addition to these significant changes were made unilaterally without consulting the very stakeholders who in time will have to implement the bill's provisions. Such an approach flies in the face of the collaborative tone adopted by the First Minister when she took office exactly 1 year ago today. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, this is not merely enabling legislation, as the Minister asserts. Instead, the bill contains wide-ranging reforms that need to be the subject of robust scrutiny, particularly following their implementation. I therefore urge the Minister to revisit the proposals at stage two, and whilst the Conservatives will support his motion today, this support and continued support will be conditional and dependent on the amendments brought forward at stage two, particularly on the definition.
Many thanks. And we now move to open debate, and I call on Christian Allard to be followed by Margaret McDougall. At the moment, we have enough time for a generous 6 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I would like maybe to repeat the word of the convener when she said that the topic is maybe dry and dust, but I don't think it is. I think it's about people, and it's quite important. We had some good contribution already, quite interesting what we can move forward in the future to see how we can review this legislation. And I would have to say it is enabling legislation. This is the main point about this legislation, and I was delighted to participate into it as a member of the Justice Committee, and I'd like to as well thank all the clerk and all the team to help us prepare this committee report at stage one. It's really this Community Justice Bill is really introducing not only a new model for community justice, but more importantly, an enabling model. One that the detail of how the arrangements are to work in practice will be set out in the national strategy. That's all part of the bill, said the Minister, a national performance framework and the relevant guidance. And it's in post-legislation, Presiding Officer, after the bill is passed. Hence the enabling. As the convener already stated, the evidence received did not show any great enthusiasm for the bill. I put it to the fact that many participants maybe were looking to respond to prescriptive legislation, and what we have is the opposite, enabling legislation. Some must have expected to come and oppose top-down legislation. It wasn't there. Instead, the discussion were very much around what every participant would like to see in how community justice could be better delivered and monitored. One thing they all agreed on is that legislative reform is needed. apart from some conveners, of course. We made recommendations, presenting officer, following the work that we did and the evidence that we received and heard. Would like first to say where we are, because it's important after what Margaret Mitchell said. I was trying, and maybe clarifies the point I was trying to make. Community justice authorities were set up in 2006 in the Management of Offenders Act 2005 to reduce reoffending. That was the main point. For example, in my own region, a part of the region I represent, the Northern Community Justice Authority that covers a large geographical areas, with Albany City, Albany Shire and Moray, is clear on what it was set up for. And it's what they say online. Community justice authorities were set up across Scotland to make our communities safer by reducing reoffending and improving the management of offenders. It is clear what the role is, and they stated, our role is to coordinate the delivery of offender services by council, voluntary organisations and other partners, and to ensure a close cooperation between community and prison services to aid the rehabilitation of offenders. So all that is very clear. Let me finish my point. The Glasgow Community Justice Authority talks about reducing reoffending throughout partnership. They say we aim to reduce reoffending as well as improving outcomes for communities, offenders and the criminal justice system. To do this, we have established a strong partnership across the city with those agencies who deliver high-quality services that reduce the risk posed by offenders and to reduce reoffending. They said that online. This is how we define community justice in Scotland, or as I see it, if Margaret Mitchell wants
Margaret
to.
Mitchell.
If we're looking at community justice, it's important that we factor into any definition of it the ability to stop, prevent offending in the first place by early intervention, rather than merely looking at reoffending after the effect.
Christiana.
I more than agree with the member on this, and I think we all agree on this. Prevention is very, very important. The question is it to be invisible? And if you look at what we had before and how community justice worked in Scotland, it's very much a small changing of what we were doing, but we're not going to involve prevention. And I know that Barnardo's, as highlighted in the briefing to MSPs, that the definition of community justice should include prevention. I'm content that the definition of community justice in Scotland doesn't include prevention. It never did, as far as I can see it, in legislation. I'm happy that the Minister will consider including diversion, because diversion is different. Diversion will include, of course, offenders. There is some of the wording I would like to change in the bill. We could find an alternative to the word offender to start with. I have to say that I agree with Endeavour Trust. The term offender is usually viewed as a negative label and contributes to the stigma faced by those who have committed an offence. And really, presenting officer, the point is, how long do you keep that offender label after you committed an offence, I would ask? Do we want people who committed an offence to be known as an offender for the rest of their life? So this is a point that I would like the Minister to think about. Pete White of Positive Prison, Positive Futures made the case for the term offender to be removed from the bill and suggested it to be replaced with a wording, hold on, it's quite a long wording, persons who have at any time been convicted of an offence. I'm not so sure about that wording. I won't be prescriptive today, presenting officer, but I would like to enable the Minister and his team to find a better wording for the people this bill is seeking to help. The Minister already knows my views on some words I would want to be added to the bill. I know this not take it to our report, we didn't take it to our report, but nevertheless, there's a case to recognise that the diversity and multitude of organisations engaged in community justice today should be something to celebrate and not to label as a crowded landscape or cluttered landscape, like we heard earlier. When I hear cluttered and crowded, you know, I think variety and diversity. I read from the policy memorandum of the bill that the private sector has a role to play. It says the new model draws on the characteristic identified by Scottish Government, one being effective local partnership and collaboration that brings together public, third and private sector partners and local communities to deliver shared outcomes that matter to people. And in his opening remarks, the minister didn't talk about the private sector, and I would love the private sector to make it to the bill somehow. You told us on the 3rd of November, Minister, that we have some good, proactive employers who are working with local authorities and the Scottish Prison Service.
As you draw to a close, please.
Yeah, they are engaging to provide employment opportunities. And I met one of the person at lunchtime who was going through the road to recovery, who did point it out that, you know, we only speak to the third sector. You know, there are a lot of people in the private sector who will give us, work. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I like this bill because I'm a great fan of enabling legislation. I believe that how it will work in practice is not for us to decide. This enabling bill is the best way to tackle reoffending. Presiding
Officer. You must close, please. Many thanks. Now call on Margaret McDougall to be followed by Gail Paterson, a generous 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to take part in this debate today. It's important that we get the Community Justice Bill right to support a reduction in reoffending through joint working and an innovative thinking. Today we shall be supporting the bill. However, Labour do have a few issues with its current format, and I urge the Scottish Government to consider these as the bill progresses. The current Community Justice Authority model seems to have made a small impact on reducing reoffending rates, although there has been no consistency across Scotland. It has lacked a clear national strategy, and there are no measures in place to monitor its effectiveness. The range of bodies involved in it has led to, and I hate to repeat this, cluttered landscape with no clear direction, and the bill before us today recognises that this needs to change. It was argued that creating 32 community justice partnerships compared to the current 8 would not help reduce that clutter. However, it will be overseen by a national body that will provide a national strategy and a framework that will produce an annual report, which is a step forward and one that needs to happen. However, as I said in opening, I have a few issues with the current bill. The definition of community justice, clarity of roles, and the role of the third sector are just a few. I was pleased to hear the Minister say today that he will look at the definition again, because the definition of community justice presented to us in the bill is problematic. It doesn't refer to preventative or early intervention, and it also fails to include victims and their families. During evidence sessions, both Scottish Women's Aid and Victim Support Scotland were concerned about the lack of focus on victims in both the definition and throughout the bill. While Bernardo Scotland argued that the definition, and I quote, should be widened to include the need to support children, families, victims, witnesses, and the wider community, not just individuals with convictions. And I end quote. We can't view these issues in isolation, and as I said at the committee evidence sessions, the Community Justice Bill should have a clear focus on victims and their families. In addition to this, there should be a greater focus on the preventative spending and early intervention, so we not only reduce the rates of reoffending, but reduce first-time offending as well, which is at the heart of what we want to achieve. We can't improve outcomes for victims, offenders, and our local communities if they are not even mentioned in the bill. The bill also needs further clarity on the roles and responsibilities of local community justice partners and community planning partnerships. I agree with Bernardo's that the role of CPPs lacks clarity within the bill, while Dr. Foster of Forth Valley Health Board argued it's very important that delivery should be through community planning partnerships, because they are the vehicle that we are currently working with. They are our local partners in tackling many issues, end quote. The role that CPPs play in community justice needs to be clearly defined and set out within this bill. And I agree with the committee recommendation that the bill needs to clearly specify that CPPs have responsibility for community justice with a view to making the new arrangements as clear as possible. Concern was also raised about who these named partners should be. Evidence was given to the committee about the importance of stable housing in reducing reoffending. So will the minister consider including housing provider representatives as a community justice partner and have housing provision as an indicator in the annual report? Like the Criminal Justice Voluntary Sector Forum, I am concerned about how the bill will interact with the third sector and third sector organisations. Given that currently the third sector is listed as a provider rather than a partner within the bill. While the bill states that the third sector should be engaged with, I suggest it would be better for the third sector to be defined as a community justice partner, given many services and projects are delivered by them. At the very least, a statutory duty to engage with the voluntary sector should be introduced, as evidence has suggested. And I welcome the Minister's comments on the third sector in his opening remarks. Lastly, on the point of funding, from talking to third sector organisations, it's apparent that we need to consider moving away from an annual funding to a three-year model to allow for sustainability and to reduce the uncertainty which currently exists. This would allow voluntary organisations to forward plan instead of constantly wondering where the next tranche of funding was coming from. As the Stage 1 Committee report states, these concerns have existed over a number of years, and the convener mentioned this as well, but no action has been taken. And I urge the Minister to take this on board and take action to address this long-standing issue. I also worry that in terms of transitional funding of £1.6 million for the next 3 years, split between 32 local authorities across Scotland, won't be enough to support the changes, more so given the financial pressures on public services at this time. Because that works out at around £16,700 per year per local authority. And this is cause for concern. If the system is not properly resourced to deal with the increased workload of community justice partners, then many projects will be at risk due to the lack of sustainable funding. Yet, the new Community Justice Scotland, which is being created, will receive £2.2 million for that same period. To conclude, Presiding Officer, while I'm happy to support the general principles of the bill, I believe there is still a lot to be done to improve on what's before us today. We need a wider definition of community justice, which is inclusive of preventative measures and early intervention. I also feel that the bill should mention and give consideration to victims and communities, not just offenders. Further clarity over both the roles of CGPs and the third sector is required, as well as who the CGA partners will be. I'm supportive of the bill, but I'm keen to see what amendments the government will propose to improve it at stage two. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now, Colin Gill-Paterson, to be followed by Alison McInnes. A generous 6 minutes only.
Many thanks, Presiding Officer. Can I start by acknowledging the work of all those involved, both past and present, across all of Scotland's current justice authorities? These changes are not a reflection on their work, and I feel their work so far should be highlighted and indeed appreciated. Presiding Officer, as a member who takes an interest in the welfare of women, I find it of interest that this bill was brought forward due to the concerns in a report by the Commission on Women's Offenders, who stated there were significant structural and funding barriers to the effective delivery of offender services in the community and that radical reform was required. And equally, Audit Scotland found that there were many bodies involved in reducing reoffending and and I quote, different governance and accountability arrangements and geographical boundaries resulting in a complex landscape, end of quote. Women offenders were central to these concerns, where even the prison service found themselves dealing with many different authorities with regard to the through care of prisoners after prison release. This complex landscape is not only unhelpful to the prisoner service, but also, more importantly, to the individuals who require community justice service. It is easy to see that with so many organisations involved, that individuals will fall through the net towards feeling unsupported, and then ultimately reoffending and return to prison. And as Dame Eilish Angelini pointed out, in the case of women, we are potentially talking about individuals who have mental health problems who require that support to prevent reoffending. Indeed, the statistics in 2009-10 show that 30% of convicted offenders were reconvicted within 1 year. And in terms of individuals with mental health difficulties, as supported by Dame Angelini, this cycle is not being helped by the continuous return to prison. Change is certainly required, Presiding Officer. Therefore, it is positive to note that the Scottish Government is currently developing the national outcomes for community justice with partners and stakeholders. I understand the draft outcomes attempts to address the two main issues with the current model and I have touched on so far. These are structural outcomes and person-centric outcomes, which include a greater equality of access to services for people with a history of offending. The Commission on Women Offenders report recommended a national service for community justice, as well as for these to be reassurance on the better outcomes for women offenders locally, undertaken at a national level. As members will note, as part of this bill, a new national agency will be formed called Community Justice Scotland. The idea of a central agency to provide a strong leadership to drive forward improvements in community justice outcomes and to provide oversight and support for the delivery of community justice services is a welcoming prospect. However, what is further welcoming is allowing the local flexibility and planning in the delivery of community justice services through groups of community justice partners in Scotland's 32 local authority areas. Such partners include the local council, police, health board, fire service, prison service, the courts and Skills Development Scotland. The key to the success of this bill is in the name, community justice. The more local in delivery of service will allow for local circumstances to be considered and, like many other local services, should see positive results. The proposed new model for community justice hopes to achieve an appropriate balance between the strong national leadership and local flexibility. It presents a more collaborative approach to community justice, driven towards both nationally and locally by a common aim to secure better outcomes for people and the communities. Like the Scottish Government, I wholeheartedly agree that local leadership and ownership of the community justice is vital to success of this new model. And I welcome that the responsibility of resolving local issues will rest with local statutory community justice partners. However, the national body will be there for any support, assistance or indeed advice. I further understand that the bill will continue to respect the lines of accountability of community justice partners. This bill, through strong national leadership and local delivery, should go a long way to helping to prevent reoffending. However, the bill also seeks to reform the cluttered landscape so often talked about, impeding on community justice. And by closer cooperation, there is a good prospect that this will be achieved. As a member of the Justice Committee, I will continue to listen to the views of all groups and individuals who have a vested interest in community justice. And I would certainly encourage everyone to have their say, and I welcome the submissions so far. This is just the first stage for hopefully providing a new model of community justice in Scotland and strengthening local strategic planning of community justice services. And I'm sure between now and the final vote of this bill, we can together bring about what this bill desires to achieve. Presiding Officer, I wish to commend the Government for bringing forward this legislation, particularly for women, and I further commend the continuing passage of this bill through the Parliament with a good end result. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now call on Alison MacInnes, to be followed by Roderick Campbell. A generous 6 minutes, no
Thank
more,
you
please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to be debating the Community Justice Bill today. I've long campaigned for a more effective and compassionate justice system, one that reduces reliance on incarceration and focuses on community reparations and rehabilitation. There's a surfeit of evidence that poverty, inequality and crime are inextricably linked, and yet we keep on sending people to prison, and reoffending rates remain high and largely static. The Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service, Colin McConnell, was recently quoted as saying, "I am not at all proud of the fact that we incarcerate more of our fellow Scots per head of population than almost every other developed nation across Western Europe. Our apparent obsession with incarceration, disproportionately impacting as it does on the most deprived in our society, casts a dark shadow." Well, Colin McConnell is right to say that punishment and retribution has dominated penal policy for too long, and the economic and social costs of offending and reoffending are immense. We waste so many resources picking up the pieces. Lives are ruined, communities are blighted, and potential is lost. And when we look at those who are in our criminal justice system, we can see that we've failed to tackle the underlying problems. Mental health problems, history of abuse, addiction, poverty, exclusion from education, and being in the care system. We know what lies behind the chaotic lives that lead to prison, and worse than that, we also know what makes a difference. So it's time for a change. The bill could, and I stress could, be that change that we need. Liberal Democrats want safer communities, people brought to justice when they offend, robust community justice schemes, but we also want everyone to have a chance to get back on track. But that robust but compassionate targeted community justice system, flexible enough to respond to individual needs, will benefit everyone in Scotland. The genesis of this bill was the Angelini report, which highlighted the disparate nature of arrangements for offenders and the lack of strategic leadership and accountability in the delivery of offender services in the community. A cluttered landscape, short-term funding, inconsistent service provision, and difficulties in measuring impact. All of which the Commission concluded as inhibiting greatly the potential to reduce reoffending. And the Commission concluded that a radical reform of existing systems and working practices was required. In the intervening 3 years, the proposals have been through many iterations. And many argue that what the government now proposes in the bill is a compromise too far. That the Community Justice Bill is well-intentioned, but as currently drafted is too timid to bring about the dramatic change needed, and I do share some of those concerns. I say we shouldn't shy away from more radical change if that's what it takes. Audit Scotland, in its report on CJAs, Community Justice Authorities, also criticised the cluttered landscape. But it's not getting any better. In fact, there's a real risk with this bill of it becoming more jumbled and opaque. And in supplementary written evidence from the conveners of CJAs, they've told us, "We remain very concerned that issues around authority, responsibility, accountability and leadership remain unresolved." And in a written briefing from seven organisations, including the Howard League, we heard, "If we are to reduce the use of imprisonment in Scotland, there will need to be a greater shift in emphasis and resources towards early prevention, diversion and community-based responses to offending behaviour." They said good intentions are not enough. We must ensure that any proposed structural changes have a realistic chance of achieving this shift. And while we welcome the creation of a national body with a specific focus on non-custodial sentencing, we are concerned that it does not have the necessary powers to deliver the fundamental change required. I would urge the government to heed the warnings in our committee report and come forward at stage two with amendments that address some of the weaknesses that we've identified. And I appreciate that the Minister has already today addressed some of those. But the issues include the definition of community justice. It's currently too narrow. Others have said that. It should include prevention and early intervention. Leadership and accountability lines and the interplay between national strategy and local provision must be clarified. The role of the third sector in the provision of community justice has been and remains crucial to its success, and that must be safeguarded in the bill. There surely must be a duty placed on community planning partners to engage with the third sector at all points in planning and the delivery process. There remains some concern about the setting up of the community justice partnerships as opposed to channelling the work directly through community planning partnerships. And the planning of community justice should become a responsibility of CPPs. I hear the caveats that the Minister has said about the difficulties of doing that, but if there's some way of identifying a way of placing that responsibility, I think that would help. The powers of the national body to direct when local delivery is failing needs to be articulated more clearly. Other significant policy changes being considered, such as the decisions around the women's estate and the government's consultation on increasing the presumption against short-term prison sentences, will increase reliance on community justice services and means that the structures need to be absolutely right if we're to maximise the benefits that we want to see. The role of housing in preventing reoffending is significant, and Shelter Scotland are right to point to the need for us to specify and quantify the kind of issues that the national strategy should cover. As the committee report concludes, there is merit in the general approach, but much more needs to be done to strengthen strategic leadership and accountability. Before I close, Presiding Officer, community justice authorities have faced criticism, but I want to acknowledge the work of all those involved in CGAs, especially over the last few years as the organisations have matured. And I think particularly of the significant reduction in youth reoffending that has occurred on their watch. The knowledge and experience amongst officers and elected members must not be lost as we move forward. Scottish Liberal Democrats will support the general principles of the bill this evening, but we remain of the view that there will need to be some significant changes at stage two if we are to support the bill progressing further. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Roderick Campbell to be followed by Dave Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to take part in this debate. While there may be concerns about the proposals, with some exceptions, there seems little enthusiasm for the current arrangements. The current system, which relies on community justice authorities to ensure consistent and effective community justice throughout Scotland, has led to implementation issues and limited progress in reducing reoffending rates, albeit that reoffending rates are at their lowest for 16 years. As Audit Scotland argued in their review of the present model, quote, CGAs were established to improve joint working and reduce reoffending. They have made progress in bringing people together, but have had little impact on reducing reoffending. The way they were set up has significantly limited their effectiveness, and there are no national agreed measures to assess their performance. Stronger leadership is required if reoffending is to be significantly reduced. I agree with that. If we are to tackle reoffending, we need a model, an alternative to custody that works. And we also need to take on board the importance, as many members have already said, of preventative measures, whether in the strategy or otherwise. This bill is a compromise that removes the existing CGA model and combines aspects of a national body providing leadership and strategic direction with local delivery. By doing so, the bill addresses inherent weaknesses in the current system and creates the framework for a model that I hope will help achieve the Scottish Government's goal. If I may, I can just quote from that goal, quote, a justice system that contributes positively to a flourishing Scotland, helping to create an inclusive, respectful society in which all people and communities live in safety and security. Individual and collective rights are supported, and disputes are resolved fairly and swiftly. An admirable aspiration. On the topic of streamlining the cluttered landscape of services that the CGA model is often currently described as, this bill sets out a framework for more effective community justice services, beginning with local implementation. Responsibility for reaching outcomes is given to 32 community justice local authorities, with more intimate knowledge of their localities, respective issues and strengths, which ought to allow for more effective organisation and planning. In response to concerns that replacing 8 CGAs with 32 such authorities will further contribute to the cluttered landscape, I think we need to accept that aiding past offenders may necessitate diverse services, such as housing, employment, health and education, being involved. As the Minister has said in evidence, if I may dare to quote him, quote, we must reflect on the fact that some people whom we are trying to help by reducing their reoffending and getting them back into a positive place have extremely complex needs, which inevitably may need to be tackled by a multi-agency approach. Alison McInnes has referred earlier on to the evidence of Audit Scotland, but I think Audit Scotland accepted in evidence certain complexities here. Indeed, Mark Roberts said there are more than 1,300 different community services provided by different providers across Scotland, which means that an awful lot of players are involved and need to be involved and engaged. The complexity that we have been discussing is almost inevitable with work in this area. So I think we have to accept that some kind of cluttered landscape is required. That being said, the framework for reflective collaboration that the Bill suggests, however cluttered, means that community partners like Police Scotland and the Scottish Prison Service are obligated to cooperate with one another, as well as with members of local communities, in both the planning and delivery phases, to maximise effectiveness. Local organisations will also maintain some discretionary power over how they share information and work, judging which collaborative efforts are most effective to further simplify their services. Community partners and local agencies that already work together need to continue to do so. With regard to the role of the third sector specifically, my view is that the transition from 8 CGAs to 32 such authorities will not necessarily limit the input of third sector organisations. As noted in committee evidence, however, third sector organisations provide roughly one-third of current community justice services, making their participation and input significant. And Section 18 of the Bill certainly seems to me to provide an opportunity for third sector groups to engage effectively in planning and implementing services. I leave it to the Government to decide if the Bill could be strengthened in that respect, but I certainly welcome the comments of the Minister earlier in that regard. Alongside the operational responsibility delegated to local authorities and community partners, the Bill establishes Community Justice Scotland to provide national leadership and an opportunity for innovation as well as oversight and assurance of outcomes. I accept that the degree of interaction with the community planning partnerships may not be clear from the Bill, but I think we need to avoid the pitfalls that too much prescription in legislation might bring. Community Justice Scotland will, I hope, develop a strategy that will allow local service providers to work towards the same outcomes. On the issue of how national leadership will be balanced with the duties of local providers, as we know, Community Justice Scotland will not provide community justice services themselves. Rather, they will work in collaboration with local agencies and community justice partners to establish a national framework and strategy that service providers will then carry out. In response to questions about the allocation of funds, as I understand it, the national authority it has proposed will also take input from community justice partners in order to best prioritise the distribution of funds at a national level. So it should, I hope, be fully responsive. And on the issue of providing oversight and assurance of the delivery of community justice outcomes, I believe that the Bill certainly provides a marked improvement over the current model. As the Commission on Women's Offenders noted, a primary weakness of the CGA model is the inability to measure community justice successes. Establishing national standards against which each local agency and community justice outcome will be measured will allow for analysis of what services and programmes are effective. Finally, addressing concerns that the Bill too narrowly defines community justice in relation to those who are already offended, it's clear that early preventative measures are critical in limiting reoffending rates. I'm sympathetic to the belief that a more holistic approach to community justice measures, as well as reducing short-term sentencing, can be productive in limiting offending in the future. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I believe there's work to do, and there's certainly work to do on the issue of short-term funding. And I need take the view that we need to clarify certain aspects of the Bill, but in my view, it's a substantial step in the right direction.
Many thanks. I now call David Stewart, to be followed by Sandra White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to be able to speak in this afternoon's debate. As a fresh-faced 24-year-old and newly qualified social worker in the early 1980s, unlike my current character, I worked in community justice in Dumfries, and I remember vividly working with a caseload of clients on probation, aftercare, and one on a life licence who was convicted of murder, while the ink was barely dry on my social work qualification. So I discovered first-hand, Presiding Officer, the social problems facing offenders and also victims. And in part, that was my motivation for launching a Members' Bill last session to create a Victims Commissioner, which members will know exists in England, Wales, Northern Ireland, and across Europe. Alas, Christine Graham's not here, but alas, the Justice Committee ran out of time from a bill, but I do believe that the time will come again for a Victims Commission no bill. So I say to members, watch this space. I don't think it will be, however, before the election in May, but I will leave that for members to decide. What do we mean by community justice? Well, I find an interesting quote in the Harvard Law Review, which puts it like this, and I quote, "Community justice represents not a simple return to the rehabilitative ideal, but an approach to crime and punishment that is radically different from that of traditional criminal justice process. Community justice initiatives emphasise attacking the causes of crime, rehabilitating individual offenders, and repairing the harm caused by crime, rather than punishing offenders according to traditional retributive or deterrence concerns." As we've already heard, Presiding Officer, Scotland's imprisonment rate is the second highest among the nations of Western Europe. In light of this, I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's words from the 1st of September this year, which stressed the need to actively address the underlying causes of offending behaviour, using imprisonment far less frequently as a disposal. And we've heard from members earlier that the Commission on Women Offenders, Audit Scotland and the Scottish Government's consultation papers about what the current issues are, and they've been well rehearsed this afternoon, although I promise, Presiding Officer, not to mention the cluttered landscape again. I think it was the seventh time it's been mentioned in the debate. So we know what the issues are: lack of opportunity for strategic leadership and accountability within community justice setup, inconsistency of service provision, and difficulties in measuring the impact of these, and also funding is clearly a problem. Many campaign groups have expressed concerns that the detailed proposals in the bill show that Community Justice Scotland will lack the necessary accountability functions and a robust strategic leadership model, needing it to make a strong national body. Today, though, I'd like to take a step back to look at the overall purpose of the bill concerning community justice. Now, the work of the third sector partner in this field is crucial, but I do welcome the Minister's earlier comment, where he made a strong commitment to the third sector, and I certainly welcome that, as someone in part of my life worked for SCVO, so I'm a big fan and enthusiast of the work of the third sector. So even in the initial report, the Commission on Women Offenders highlighted that the third sector was concerned about the short-term and fragmented nature of funding for interventions, resulting in necessary competitiveness between third sector providers. Perhaps I can give you an example from my patch in the Highlands and Islands. Michael Stewart, who is no relation, from the Outer Hebrides Criminal Justice Social Work, agreed with that above comment, and he said, and I quote, "The short-termism of funding makes it very difficult for third sector organisations to survive and not to have to morph and change in order to chase pots of money." Now, this is an issue that has persisted over a number of years and needs to be addressed now. Yet the bill does not set out adequate funding arrangements for the delivery services. Indeed, it does not reference how the third sector will be engaged as part of the new arrangements. Although, in contrast, to give some fairness to my remarks, I echo the words of the Highland Council, and they've said, "For a light-touch agency, and I'm quoting, with limited power and authority, Community Justice Scotland seems to be significantly resourced." My understanding of the intention for Community Justice Scotland's role would be in considering wider social implications impacting community justice and producing the overall strategy to implement community justice moving forward. It's strange then that the Bill's definition for community justice, and other members have obviously referenced this as well, is that it's restricted only to those who have already committed an offence. And COSLA have stated that the definition in the Bill was not consulted upon, and I quote, "It appears to have come as a surprise to stakeholders and statutory partners, especially as it differs from the Scottish Government's 2014 consultation." So a new community justice system must recognise the role of services in preventing offending and for possible direct resources towards these services, rather than waiting till people are already in the system. A broader lens is also needed to address the causes of crime that the Cabinet Secretary is committed to combating. I will highlight in the few seconds remaining, Presiding Officer, one such structural cause of the bill, which is the link between homelessness and reoffending. Now, Shelter Scotland and a range of other organisations have called for the bill to require community justice partnerships across the country to address this housing need. Now, without a stable home, the risk of reoffending is greatly increased, and yet we know that 50% of people in prison lose their homes, and that 30% of liberated prisoners do not have a home to go to, and that's over 6,000 people a year. So providing housing and independent support to sustain tenancies is one of the key factors which will help ex-prisoners not to reoffend, and therefore benefit the individuals and local communities. So in closing, Presiding Officer, while this may well be dealt with in community justice future strategy, inclusion within the bill ensures a legislative grounding for issues that evidence has shown must be addressed for people to move away for crime. And although I've got some minor criticisms about the bill, in overall terms, I support the general principles of the bill. Presiding Officer, thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Sandra White to be followed by Jane Baxter.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And a note to Dave Stewart's mention of his victim and changing of names, and other members having mentioned changing of names. Well, if it's any experience of mine trying to speak to the Victim and Witnesses Bill, we spent hours with lawyers in regards to they wanted to change the name of victim. So I wish you all the best of luck in that particular one and trying to get a name change anyway, and I'm sure I'll be thoroughly behind you in that. Having previously been a member of the Justice Committee and having met with many local communities and community groups as well in regards to how the justice system engaged with them, because I think that's really the crux of this particular bill, how the justice system is perceived by the public out there and how they actually engage with it, I'm really pleased to be able to speak in this debate. And I think it's really imperative that the model that we're talking about just now is driven at local level. And as the Minister, I think, said in his opening remarks, local leadership is vital in the delivery of this model. As is the recognition that basically we're not just talking about economic aspects here, we're talking about human beings and people's lives as well. I think that's a really important point to remember. I came to this debate, Presiding Officer, because I wanted to speak in it, but also I think most people here have got a great interest in the human aspects of social justice, and I speak to schools as others do, and I just happened to go to speak to school, Glasgow Academy, next week, and I have the paper here, and it's about criminal justice, and they have a number of questions they wanted to ask me, so I'll mention a couple of the questions, and I think I'll perhaps deal with them as I see it, and hopefully they'll get copies of this debate, and it'll make my life much easier when I go and speak to them and they ask me questions next week. One of the questions was, prison is ineffective in reforming offenders, and I'll talk to that, I think. Prison damages the most vulnerable offenders. And one of the other questions was, women in prison are victims and not criminals. There are other questions, but I picked these particular ones out. Reduce reoffending, I mean, I think others have said already, the revolving door. A number of members have mentioned, I think it was Elaine Smith, Elaine had already mentioned the economic costs of reoffending. But as we also said, there's a talk of the human cost to that also. But Audit Scotland, you know, gave a report in 2012 about the economic costs of reoffending, and Gil Paterson also mentioned about the 30% of convicted offenders, you know, basically convicting again within 1 year. 9,500 people were convicted in 2010-2011, 22% of the total convictions, and they had 10 or more convictions, previous convictions. And individuals released for a custodial sentence of 6 months or less are reconvicted more than twice as often as those given a community payback order. And I think that's something we have to look at in this particular bill as well. There are other areas out there that we can actually look at to ensure that people don't go through this revolving door. As I said, Jess, I think when we look at the situation, and Elaine Murray said this again, if we looked at preventative measures and we prevented these people from reoffending, the money we saved from that could be put into other issues, provision of community justice, which basically is preventative measures. And I think that's the way we're all wanting to go. It may take a wee bit longer, but I think this bill, you know, touches on that particular one. And one of the areas I picked out of the bill was basically the improvements in the provision of community justice, and also making the general public Elaine Murray once again did say this, the general public aware of the benefits of community justice. It's something that the general public tend not to know about. And I don't know if it's something to do with perhaps the media that don't actually put that out, that there are, you know, alternatives to custody. I think that's something that we really should look at. And if we can look at that properly, I think this bill can achieve many, many things. The other issue I wanted to speak on was women in prison. And, you know, basically it's been mentioned, Dame Angelini, basically her evidence at the Justice Committee and also the commission that she had put forward. And I just want to read a quote from Dame Angelini. She mentions a very significant portion of the women in Scotland who go to prison should not be there at all. Many of them, or at least a very significant percentage, serve very short sentences of imprisonment. Many suffer from significant mental health issues and difficulties within prison. And once they're out of prison, it doesn't necessarily reduce their behaviour, because once they come out of prison, a couple of weeks later, they're back in again because they've hit the closet dealer, as they call it, or they went to some other form of addiction. And that particular cycle is constant and it's very difficult to deal with. So I think we need to look at this in the round. And having been a member of the Justice Committee, as I said, and, you know, spoken to lots of members on the Justice Committee, I think we're all coming from the same, you know, singing from the same hymn sheet. It's how we get there, basically. I think we've got to look at this new model. We've got to stop the reoffending. As I said, yeah, there is an economic hit there, but there's also a very great social hit. You've got women in prison who have families and children outside. They're affected. That affects the social aspect of it. Also, it affects many people's lives. And we've got to start somewhere to look at how we can stop the revolving door and how we can stop women getting into prison when sometimes they're more of a victim than they are of the person who perpetrated the crime. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Jane Baxter to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I no longer sit on the Justice Committee, but my last appearance at that committee was for the first evidence session pertaining to this bill. I think that was in September. So I took the chance this week to read the official report to remind myself of what I said. But I was struck by a comment made by Cleland Sneddon from the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives. In acknowledging that the findings of both the Angelini report on women offenders and the Audit Scotland report reducing reoffending in Scotland were important for Solace, he said, the analogy that we have used for the existing system is that it is like looking at the National Health Service, but only at the treatment end. We became very effective at managing offenders and discharging orders, but less successful at having a strategic overview of our work. And there was an absence around prevention and early intervention. So in that regard, the policy intention of the bill, which is to help create a stronger community justice system based on local collaborative strategic planning and delivery with national leadership, support and assurance, and importantly, local delivery, partnerships and collaboration at its heart, does reflect the need to take a whole system approach. Because one of the fundamental concepts of any debate on justice must surely be that of recidivism. How do we move people away from reoffending? This will not be achieved by simply focusing on the offender. We must create communities which are able to provide the homes, the skills and the jobs which would go such a long way towards making it possible to pursue more positive and rewarding life choices and lifestyles. How we deal with this notion forms a cornerstone on which we build a model of the success of our entire justice system. Community justice authorities, working alongside other relevant bodies, were set up to plan for reducing reoffending in their designated areas. This, alongside a remit to monitor performance, promote good practice, distribute funding and report to Scottish ministers, has formed part of the community justice strategy in Scotland for the past 8 years. And while we have seen moderate success in state in rates of reoffending, there have been a number of issues surrounding the operation of the current community justice system in Scotland. Both the Angelini report and the Audit Scotland report raise concerns around the operation of the 8 community justice authorities covering the country. I therefore welcome the bill in its attempt to tackle issues in the current system, as we must continue to strive for success in improving community justice. The creation of Community Justice Scotland, which will have a range of remits including overseeing performance, promoting improvement, publishing a strategy for innovation and learning and development, promoting the Scottish Government's national strategy, reviewing the national performance framework and more will help, with a specific focus on non-custodial sentencing. Replacing the 8 community justice authorities with 32 community justice partnerships, one for each local authority, and establishing a new national body, Community Justice Scotland, should help to tackle some of the concerns raised around the current model of operation. However, as much as the bill does address these concerns, it also, as it stands, raises further questions. And I will focus on one, that of accountability, and ask that the Minister address this in order to ensure that we properly tackle the problems that were prevalent in the model of operation we seek to replace. The bill as it stands does not offer sufficient clarity on what the accountability to Community Justice Scotland will be, which will ensure that the objectives set out are being met by individual local community justice partnerships, although I note that the Minister did make comments about this in his opening remarks, and I'd be interested to hear some more about that as the bill progresses. And if I can again quote Cleland Sneddon, who said in evidence to the committee that the outcomes will flow from the national strategy and the national outcomes framework. The outcomes will be customised to different areas to reflect the local context. And that prompted a discussion at my one committee on this topic, a discussion on local versus national commissioning, urban and rural context and the role of the third sector. As others have said today, there are currently some 1,300 providers of services. So it may be the case, as Mark Roberts of Audit Scotland said, that complexity is almost inevitable. And whilst I agree that's true to some extent, I believe that strong, effective local partnership working is a powerful way of making sense of that complexity. And I look forward to hearing more on this from the Minister in due course. We've seen differences of opinion on the level of accountability desired, with councils preferring a light-touch approach and the Scottish Association for the Care and Resettlement of Offenders, amongst others, seeking increased accountability from local bodies to Community Justice Scotland. This raises the question, will Community Justice Scotland have the required powers deemed necessary to deliver the changes the Bill seeks to make? With our imprisonment rate in Scotland standing at the second highest in Western Europe, it is clear that we must provide adaptations to our justice system in order that it works more effectively. To reduce imprisonment rates, we must also tackle the issue of re-offending, and a strong progressive community justice policy could help take steps towards this. I accept the principle of shifting our view on how we address current attitudes to the use of imprisonment. Further to this, I believe that community-based responses are essential to tackle rates of offending in Scotland. This, coupled with early prevention and diversions from unnecessarily punitive custodial sentences, except where absolutely necessary, will do much to address the rate of imprisonment we see, but also the rates of re-offending that result in our oversized prison populations. And in that context, I agree with Barnardo Scotland when they highlight a key point made by the committee in its report, that the definition of community justice should include prevention and early intervention, as well as be widened to include dependent children, families of offenders and the wider community, as well as victims and witnesses. I hope that as the bill progresses, we can go some way to achieving that broader definition, and in particular, to continue to value and support the role of local services and the degree to which they should be involved in the planning and delivery of community justice services, whether that be at a strategic or a local level. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Nigel Dawn.
Presiding officer, when I got elected to Parliament in 2001, one of the biggest things in my entry at that stage was the then plan to close the prison in Peterhead. That prison, of course, had been opened in 1888. The only other thing I know about 1888, it was the year Celtic Football Club started. Peterhead was built at a cost of £57,400, and the land upon which it was built was £5,000. I'm delighted that after a long community-based campaign, which I was very happy to support and contribute to, we now have a community-facing prison at a rather more substantial cost than the £57,400 that the original prison cost. And it's already, I think, showing signs that it will contribute materially to the way in which things operate in criminal justice in the North East. Now, the staff, of course, at Peterhead are what make or break what goes on in that prison, and that's true of prisons elsewhere, and indeed in the whole community justice space, and in dealing with offenders and people who are looking as if they're heading to offenders. We need good people in place, and I think by and large that's exactly what we have. But prisons ain't the answer. Pure economics tells us that. The cost of keeping people in prison can be as much as £40,000 a year. The cost of treating people outside so that they're less likely to reoffend, not only do we know it's more successful in achieving that aim, but the cost is likely to be a quarter of that. So for people who say, bang them up, put them in prison and throw away the key, what they're actually saying is, take money out of socially useful ways in which we could spend money and waste it on something that isn't going to deliver anything very meaningful indeed. Margaret Mitchell and I spoke 10 years ago, or here she is, 10 years ago on victims and witnesses in 2005. We haven't heard an awful lot about victims in this debate. I hope that we'll hear a little bit more, because at the end of the day, the victims are actually the most important people in any consideration of criminal justice, because they're the ones whom, frankly, are often marginalised in the process, much as we've tried to do more. Now, our incarceration rates are far too high, that's for sure. If in particular we look at Scandinavian countries, they're about a third of what they are here. Now, the good news is that the United States is four times our rate, so I suppose we're considerably better than some, but not as good as we need to be. The then executive in 2004, in a consultation, used the headings reduce, rehabilitate and reform. And I think that's an excellent way of looking at the activities we have to undertake. And indeed, even the 1839 Prisons Act had as a central part of that act that the purpose of prison was reforming criminals. So reformation and reforming criminals is not a new idea, although I think it would be fair to say that in 1839, punishment probably was pretty central to what was going on. The Justice One Committee did an inquiry into reoffending in 2004, and Aberdeenshire Council said the prison environment cannot of itself be conducive to achieving the desired outcome of reducing reoffending. And I don't think anybody in the debate has said otherwise. Clive Fairweather, the late lamented inspector of prisons, was a great supporter of out-of-prison rehabilitation, and we miss him and his sage advice. Not a man I agreed with on every political matter, I hasten to add, but I think on this matter he was very clear. Now, we've heard a little bit about the definition that's in the bill of what community justice needs to be. I and the rest of us should be slightly heartened by the document the government's produced, the new model for community justice in Scotland, which came out in September 2015, which says the collection of agencies and services in Scotland that individually in partnership work to manage offenders, prevent offending. And I think that is absolutely crucial. And I hope that those words that the government has already written on something they've published are roughly similar to those that we may end up seeing in the bill. And indeed, I think if I look at section 17 of the bill, which talks about the outcomes improvement plan. First of all, I'm heartened by the use of the word outcomes, because I think that anchors what the plan has to be about. You know, don't let's be unduly prescriptive about methods, but let's focus on outcomes. And I think that creates, in the existing way in which the bill is constructed, the opportunity for these plans to address the issue of preventative spend, reducing offending, because that ought, above all, to be the outcome that we seek. Now, Presiding Officer, just in my final remarks, I think I just want to say I'm very reluctant, and always am reluctant, to add another layer to any organisation. And
I perhaps have yet to be convinced, I've not been engaged in this as it's gone through the committee, that actually adding another layer in and of itself is going to help very much. It may well do, it can do, but I'm instinctively needing to be persuaded. And similarly, just the whole process of planning, it is quite clear that the plans have to come from the community planning partnerships up to national level. But when a plan is produced by person A but has to be implemented by person B, you have the risk of there not being buy-in. I'm hugely enthusiastic where the plans come from the grassroots, reflect the experience of people at the grassroots, the more chance that they'll be successful. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Nigel Dawn to be followed by John Finney.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by echoing Gil Patterson's thanks to those who are currently doing a very good job in this area, because it is those who work in our communities with those who they are trying to prevent from reoffending who make our communities safer, and we need to thank them for everything that they do. And recognising that reducing reoffending is the primary purpose of this bill, and I don't want to add to the comments about whether that should be widened within the bill, I want to address the structure, and indeed Stuart Stevenson has just done so. It does seem to me that having a national body that can lead this and having rather more local bodies appears to make life more complex. But I think it actually has every opportunity to succeed, because providing some national leadership is certainly important and was plainly missing. And the 32 additional or new bodies are not indeed new at all. Firstly, they're based on local authorities' boundaries, which have been around for some time. And secondly, they're contiguous with community planning partnerships. Now, unless I've missed a trick, Presiding Officer, I have not yet seen within the bill the term community justice partnership. There are lots of partners, but there is no partnership. And that's quite simply because it was never defined. Quite simply, I think, because what the government is trying to do is to make other partnerships and the community planning partnership those who pick up the reins. I think I've got that right, and I'm pleased to note that I've got that right.
The minister's nodding.
Yes, indeed. Now, if I can return to the subject of funding, which was brought up by Audit Scotland in its November 2012 report, I'd simply like to read into the record their recommendations. The Scottish Government should improve arrangements for funding community justice to ensure that the money is targeted towards effective approaches to reduce reoffending, there is more flexibility to meet local needs and priorities, and allocations are more responsive to changes in demand. And so say all of us for any area of funding in public life, except could we add to that we should eliminate as far as possible short-term funding. I have yet to meet an organisation or individual in any area of life who is helped by having repeatedly to go back to look for money. It means you spend your time looking for money instead of doing the job. But on the subject of money, could I just pick up on Dr. Lane Murray's comment about the fixed costs of prisons, which I think is effectively what she was saying. We mustn't kid ourselves that we're going to get anything back from the expenditure on prisons in the short term. It's only going to be when we're actually closing prisons wholesale that we're going to get some reduction in that budget. Coming back to the structure, Presiding Officer, and the need to get from where we are to where we're going, there's clearly a transition, and that exercised quite a number of those who put in written submissions, and I have from Police Scotland, Fife Council and Fife Partnership, the NHS in Scotland, and the Scottish Working Group on Women's Offenders, all specifically commented on transitions. I don't have time to read that out. It seems to me that what we're all looking at, though, is the fact that this new structure provides an opportunity, but it does bring with it, I think, a risk and a threat. If the national body has, I'll use the word charismatic for want of a term, leadership that actually provides real people leadership, then I'm sure this can proceed and succeed. Equally, those 32 community partnerships, however they are ultimately configured, will need some leadership. The bill is silent on who should lead, and I think that's right. But it's going to come down to the actual individual people who are actually putting their heads above the parapet in whatever meetings there are and saying, hey guys, how are we going to do this?
Stuart Stevenson.
I wonder if the member might agree with me that grassroots is best, and there is an old saying that of the greatest leaders it will be said, we did it ourselves. In other words, when the leadership is invisible and the grassroots is empowered, then it tends to work pretty well.
Nigel Doyle.
I'm absolutely sure the member is right. I probably won't be there to write the history, but I think the point is that whilst we can see ways in which this can work very well, it's not difficult to see that poor leadership at the local level, and it would be particularly where two people who thought they should lead it are permanently at odds, and we have all seen that in public life. That's going to be the threat. And this doesn't prescribe a way past that, and therefore it leaves the threat very much in front of us. Finally, Presiding Officer, I wonder if I could pick up on something which I don't think anybody's yet mentioned, and that is not only what we might measure as the outcomes, but what might be achievable. Now, we know in human life that some things are easy to change, some other bits are more difficult to change, and some bits actually prove to be intractable, just because the amount of effort that goes into it is disproportionate to anything you're going to get out of it, and you don't achieve that. We know that reoffending rates are around 30% and apparently static. Now, I don't want to be in any way negative about what people can achieve, but I wonder whether we could fairly soon, by doing some research, which I'm always in favour of, work out what kind of reoffending levels we can achieve by putting some serious effort into appropriate places. It might give you a little bit of a postcode lottery, but at least let's see whether we can get from 30% to 20% to 10% or whatever. Because if we work out that we can get to 20%, but actually reducing it beyond there requires a quite disproportionate amount of effort, then it would be nice to know at least roughly where that number might be. Otherwise, there's a risk we're constantly trying to achieve something which we know gets more and more difficult. And finally, presiding officer, if I might, the point's already been made, and I think it was David Stewart made, you know, lack of housing is one of those things that we know, both statistically and from common sense, is likely to push somebody back into prison. Now, I imagine there's some kind of correlation somewhere. I haven't seen it. Maybe some of these individual issues are ones which, again, we could get some numbers on, get some idea of how important they are, and make sure that the important things really are being done and are measured as being done. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call John Finney to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the policy memorandum to the Community Justice Bill, the Scottish Government commit themselves to reducing reoffending, and they say that offending is a complex problem and there are well-established links between persistent offending and poverty, homelessness, addiction and mental illness. And they tell us that reoffending creates victims, damages community and waste potential. Talk about the complex needs of offenders, and they say that successful delivery of better outcomes for victims, offenders and communities relies therefore on a wide partnership of agencies and services working together. Now, much mention has been made of the Commission on Women Offenders and the Audit Scotland report, and what the Justice Committee focused on, whether was this proposal was the transformational change that both of these envisaged. Mention has been made of how long the existing arrangements have been into place since 2007, and the question was raised whether it was premature indeed to consider reform, with that being the case. Not very academic, but I spoke to a senior social work professional and asked about the Criminal Justice Authority, and what the person said was, they top slice our budget and I have to go to two meetings a year. Now, that's maybe very crude, but I think it does suggest that they were never fully embedded in the landscape and indeed passed many by unnoticed. But a couple of my colleagues, I think Gil Patterson and Alison McInnes, also said that it's important to realise that people were meaningfully engaged in these. There was geographic variation, and I don't think this proposal was ever meant to undervalue the work that did take place. What we're interested in is whether the 2012 reports talk about the problems, the structures, the number of bodies involved, and the accountability and funding mechanisms, and that these complex arrangements were inhibiting the potential to reduce offending. So the Justice Committee certainly accepted improvements to the community justice structures and arrangements are needed, and I suppose, therefore, is this the vehicle to take it? We have little evidence supporting the current model. I had initially said we heard little evidence, little enthusiasm, full stop, but I think we heard more a muted response. But it's very clear that if 340 folk attended the meetings and 66 consultation responses were received, that there is interest, and this is a compelling matter for communities. And it is the debate around the strong national leadership and the local flexibility that's in that. And I was keen that we heard from rural practitioners, and we did, and we heard indeed that under the existing models, one of the national offender programmes was inoperable in the West Isles because it wasn't the aggregate number of personnel involved. So that does flag up potential issues around the question of strategic commissioning and adopting a single approach. I like local. I thought all of us liked local, and I don't think we should be scared of local. As I think Nigel John said, they're very clear geographic areas set out already, and we want to see local decision-making flourish. Well, I certainly do. The greater clarity about the relationship between the two, of course, and the balance of responsibilities is something that's very important, and how it's expected to work in practice. And there are things in the horizon that are going to shape that. Mention's been made of the Scottish Government's move to more community-based disposals, and I'm certainly hugely supportive of that, and the presumption against short sentences. And the issues around another piece of legislation we dealt with that ended the automatic early unconditional release, and assurances that the Cabinet Secretary provided me in relation to the tailored support for individuals there. So it's crucial in the whole tapestry of things how this piece of legislation will work. Also, as has been made, the Scottish Prison Services through care and after care. The position of the third sector has been touched on, and indeed in relation to that matter, there could be tensions there. Does it follow that the Scottish Prison Service would deliver that? I think we've got to commend the very good work that's ongoing at the moment in a wide number of areas, and indeed commend cross-border working, which in the Christie Commission's mentioned in the policy memorandum, and that's the approach that we'd want to see taken with everything. As regards the definition, well, of course, the Christie Commission does mention prevention and early intervention, but I was reassured what I heard from the Minister there. I think on this and a number of other matters, the Minister's indicated a willingness to listen. And it's back to my flowchart diagram, whatever. It is to understand how many of all these really good initiatives dovetail together, because there's a lot of work going on. There's a myriad of acronyms, and it is to understand how they work together. So I'm not going to use the word that everyone else has been using, but I'm going to use the word horizon, because I think we do need to look forward. And with a lot of work still to be done. One thing I would want to pick up on, though, and that was something that was mentioned too, is about the measurement. And I don't want to offend bean counters, but I fear I'm going to again. If it's simply going to be stats rather than a focus on the individual, then we're not going to be measuring the real success that is actually getting an offender to turn up in the morning when a chaotic lifestyle meant that it was a challenge to get out of their bed, to turn up for an interview, to secure a job, to maintain a job. So I'm sure, Minister, you would want to pick up on that. It is about individuals, and I'd be very keen to hear more on the issue you talked about of access to universal services and no barriers. Housing's frequently mentioned, a very keen interest in housing, and guess what? It shouldn't be a surprise when anyone leaves prison. So the issue of where they're going to be accommodated, there should be some forewarning too. So if all the commendable work we hear about collaboration across the sectors is genuinely taking place, then hopefully we can resolve that issue of housing and accommodation out, because it is absolutely pivotal. And I'd like to note the issue of whether we could find an alternative to the word offenders. I thought the Minister was making an early bid when he twice used, if I noted him correctly, people with convictions. I don't know what that means for someone who is in the singular there, people with conviction, because I would hope we would all have conviction. I like the direction of travel. It certainly is the position of the Green Independent Group. We will be supporting this. Thank you very much indeed.
Many thanks. And our final open debate speaker before we turn to closing speeches is Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin my remarks in the Chamber this afternoon by saying how delighted I am to speak in this important debate on the Community Justice Bill, and I have to compliment Christine Graham and her committee on their hard work. Can I start off by saying, explicitly that I believe this SNP government has a strong record of supporting justice in Scotland and will, I am sure, continue to do everything in its power to make sure that the people of Scotland are always treated fairly under the law, no matter what. Community Justice Scotland Bill strengthens the role of community justice as a part of the Scottish Government's overall strategy to tackle the social and economic effects of reoffending in Scotland. It is important, Presiding Officer, to highlight some of the weaknesses within the current community justice model. Audit Scotland reports that the total economic and social costs of reoffending in Scotland are about £3 billion a year. 30% of convicted offenders of the convicted offenders in 2009-10 were reconvicted within 1 year. In fact, 9,500 people convicted in 2010 up to 2012, which represents 22% of the total amount of people convicted in Scotland had 10 or more previous convictions. Presiding Officer, we must do more if people are committing the same crimes over and over again. There has to be, I would suggest, more we can do. This government has an impressive record on ensuring that crime is brought to a record low, but this Community Justice Bill provides a basis for a new model for community justice in Scotland, and I wish this bill well. Under the provisions of the bill, Community Justice Scotland will be established, working closely with statutory community justice partners as set out in the policy memorandum. The aim of the bill is to help create a stronger community justice system based on local collaborative strategic planning and delivery with national leadership support and assurance. Presiding Officer, Community Justice Scotland will, I am sure, provide leadership and strategic direction for the community justice sector and promote best practice. Under the proposed arrangements, the main functions of Community Justice Scotland will be to promote the national strategy in relation to community justice prepared by Scottish ministers, promote public awareness of the benefits of community justice, to oversee and keep the Scottish ministers informed about performance in the provision of community justice, and finally promote and support improvement in the provision of community justice and making best use of resources. Currently, I understand the Scottish Government is developing a national strategy for community justice with relevant stakeholders, which in turn will set out priorities and the strategic direction. This, I believe, is expected to be published in June 2016. When it comes to reoffending, the Community Justice Bill aims to curb reoffending rates and support deterrence. A range of other Scottish Government policies are addressing the underlying causes of offending, such as homelessness, as already has been covered greatly this afternoon, poverty and drug misuse. The new national strategy for community justice will link these other strategies to ensure a joined-up approach. At the Justice Committee on the 6th of October, I am led to believe in 2015, the Minister Paul Whitehouse said, "Where we can reduce reoffending, that will have benefits for wider society and not just for the prison estate and the Scottish Prison Service. It will have benefits for communities and for families whose loved ones will not be incarcerated. The impact on children will have benefits for education provision and could generate savings there." And he went on to say he certainly agreed that tackling the issue and reduce reoffending can produce significant long-term economic and public spending benefits to Scotland. I want to conclude, Presiding Officer, by highlighting once again the importance of this bill, and it has been a pleasure to take part in this debate. The Community Justice Bill reinforces the role of community justice and is part of the Scottish Government's overall strategy, as already said, to tackle the social and economic effects of reoffending in Scotland. I look forward to seeing this bill continue to progress, and I hope for deliver for the people of Scotland. In a section of the report, I note that this new model will promote and improve culture. Each community justice outcome improvement plan will be evidenced through annual reporting, offering transparency. The statutory community justice partners will reflect on previous year's work and produce an annual report on the progress they have made in delivering the outcomes, improvement actions and other activities set out in their plans. Community Justice Scotland will consider the annual reports and provide assurance in the form of an annual report to Scottish ministers and local government leaders on the progress across Scotland towards meeting the common outcomes. This report will deliver and will offer transparency in the community justice reporting process and will provide opportunities for driving improvement and the identification and dissemination of best practice. And I wish this report well and the bill well. Thank you.
Many thanks. We now turn to the closing speeches and I call on Annabel Goldie. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Goldie.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I welcome the Stage 1 debate on the Community Justice Bill, and I too thank the Justice Committee for their comprehensive report. Over 2 years ago, I participated in the Scottish Government's debate on the initial consultation proposing wide-ranging reforms to our community justice system, and I was previously convener of the Justice 2 Committee in 2005 when it considered arrangements that were in place at that time. Arrangements, I might remind the Chamber, many felt had the potential to work and should have been given more time to prove themselves. However, following that debate 2 years ago, it became clear that the three options outlined in the consultation were not fit for purpose and ministers had to go back to the drawing board. Now, there's no shame in that. But despite a second consultation in 2014, stakeholders have argued that the proposals scrutinised by the Justice Committee, and which are the subject of today's debate, are still worryingly short of what is required. My colleague Margaret Mitchell has outlined our principal areas of concern in relation to the bill, so I will take this opportunity to review Scotland's community justice system more generally. Many members will be aware that my party did not support the Management of Offenders, etc., Scotland Act 2005. We anticipated congestion of participants, confusion and lack of clarity in both purpose and leadership. And now the Scottish Government is having to replace these 8 community justice authorities just 10 years after they were introduced. So what have others been saying? Well, in 2012, the Commission on Women Offenders pointed to myriad issues besetting CJAs, which seriously affected their performance, including a cluttered criminal justice landscape, short-term funding, a lack of accountability and leadership, and inconsistent service provision. Now, it is with no pleasure, I say, that gave me a sense of déjà vu. Separately, Audit Scotland argued that CJAs, and I quote, have had little impact on reducing reoffending. The way they were set up has significantly limited their effectiveness, and there are no nationally agreed measures to assess their performance. Well, as the only party to oppose the 2005 Act, I think it is fair to say that our fears about CJAs have been realised. And on the strength of these damning comments, two things are clear. The current system is broken and needs urgent reform. The unhappy history of CJAs compels caution, better surely to reflect on getting change right than to rush and get it wrong. Very briefly, Mr. Stevenson.
Stuart Stevenson.
And this is a genuine open question to which I have no answer. How long does the member think one should have to wait to see a change in reoffending? Because I think we probably all recognise there are no quick fixes in this.
Annabel Goldie.
You're quite right. I don't have the answer to that question. All I and other politicians can do is, as I've already indicated, try and identify what is broken, what is wrong, and try and warn about where not to go in seeking to improve things. Because during that debate in 2013, Mr. Stevenson, I urged caution and I cited the creation of a single police force as a warning for not bulldozing through change in the face of justified concern. Now, stakeholders have expressed a number of significant concerns about this bill, and I repeat my warning to the Minister. These changes should be driven by consensus, not railroaded through the Parliament to satisfy some government mission. And in his letter to the Justice Committee at the end of October, the Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs confirmed that he is, and I quote, confident that the new model for community justice and the proposals included within the bill that support it will support not only the developments described above, but also any future developments in relation to penal policy reform. Now, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Conservatives are particularly concerned that these changes we are debating today are a prelude to penal reforms that at present are the subject of another consultation that does not close until the 16th of December. And the consultation responses have not been, Minister, I really want to make progress, I don't have a lot of time. They've not even been collated or analysed, the ink's not dry, yet ministers seem to be paving the way for a new penal policy that will be complemented by the model proposed in this bill. Deputy Presiding Officer, this is not cart before horse. The horse isn't even on the horizon, it's still grazing in some distant field. We know that these penal reforms include extending the presumption against short-term sentences, and we know the government's view about that. But I would remind ministers of what Audit Scotland said, that community sentences are not necessarily more effective than imprisonment in reducing reoffending. And research published this year demonstrated that the presumption against short-term sentences does not figure prominently or explicitly in the decision-making of sentencers, and that sheriffs tend to use such sentences when there is no suitable alternative. Presiding Officer, my party has no principled objection to robust community sentences which are properly enforced, but public safety demands that we should not be emptying our prisons of violent and dangerous individuals who, with all the facts of the case before them, the judiciary felt should be behind bars. And I merely make that observation to say that community sentences are perhaps not quite the panacea the Scottish Government would have us believe. But I am really concerned about the seemingly haphazard way that the Scottish Government is approaching the implementation of its penal policy, as well as a rationale that underpins it. Let's take time to build a community justice model that the public can have confidence in, and let's take time to develop a penal system that tackles the recidivism rate while giving victims, yes, victims, too seldom mentioned, giving victims the justice they deserve.
Many thanks. I now call on Graham Pearson. 9 minutes, please, Mr. Pearson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to contribute to this Stage 1 debate, and I'm happy to reiterate these benches' support for the principles that lie behind the report at Stage 1. Much has been said around the Chamber indicating reservations about some of the issues, and I hope to visit some of these reservations in this concluding speech. But I think it worthwhile to revisit some of the aspects which caused us to consider the need for a Community Justice Scotland Bill at this time. And largely they emanate from the Angelini Report on Women Offenders and Audit Scotland Report, Reducing Reoffending in Scotland, both published in the same year, 2012. Both reports independently raise concerns regarding a lack of strategic leadership, a lack of accountability, the impact of short-term funding in terms of diverting workers away from their main task of delivering services for those who might reoffend, the inconsistency in the standards of service, a lack of true care for offenders, and Shelter, in their briefing papers for today's debate, made, and I think appropriately, a major play that the lack of appropriate housing has a very significant impact on those who may reoffend. These two reports also talked about a lack of strong leadership, statutory partners not accountable to the criminal justice authorities, and the limited capacity available to undertake the full range of work. And that was a particular comment from Audit Scotland. Taken as a whole, and I'm loath to use the term yet again this afternoon, but that seems to me to be the characteristics of what many members in the Chamber today have called a cluttered landscape. There's no doubt that in being cluttered and a landscape, it sounds to me like a soft description of a work area with too many agencies, too many organisations, too many authorities, too many relationships, leading to a complexity and a confusion for offenders and for clients who might access the services. And Rod Campbell indicated that perhaps the nature of what we're trying to deal with here occasions the fact that many agencies and authorities need to be involved. However, the description as cluttered indicates to me
that this landscape is unnecessarily untidy, is disarranged, might be described as a jumble, and certainly is irritating to those who try to organise a response to what is a very important issue. During the Minister's introduction to the debate today, I was pleased to hear that he indicated that one of the main aims of this bill is to reduce reoffending. And that aim is a laudable aim, but as has been alluded to around the chamber, it's very difficult to gather evidence of what actually works around Scotland in order that we can utilise those efforts effectively. And much has been said in the chamber that judges and others aren't aware of all the opportunities that might be out there in order to divert people away from offending. But I'd also offer that an absence of confidence in knowing which of those alternatives actually work and work for the offender or the client group is as important an impact as any other criteria. We have the second highest levels of imprisonment, as many members around the chamber have indicated. We have also, unfortunately, one of the highest levels of experience of substance abuse, both drugs and alcohol. And it has been touched on by many members that the impacts which cause and encourage reoffending are often outwith the confines of this bill, in that unemployment, a lack of education, the presence of poverty, the absence of homes, in all truth, the absence of hope is what drives people to return to prisons throughout their lives and end up losing the opportunity to play a full part in what we would call Scottish society. So I'm happy to.
Christine Graham.
Comprehensive list with which I'd agree. There's also the fact that if you're in prison, you become institutionalised in a sense, and that's difficult to break when they've got to come back and be self-sufficient.
Graham Pearson.
Yes, I would accept that, and certainly within the prisons that we visited during the time that I was part of Justice Committee, we met those in prison, both men and women, who had suffered the experience of becoming institutionalised and indeed frightened to come back out into the general society. So a commitment from the Minister that he would like to see community solutions which are locally focused and accept responsibility for what they seek to achieve is a way forward. But I'd also caution him that in indicating that he introduces this new model, he necessarily raises hopes and he creates an anticipation that things will change and it will become better. And as been alluded to by a number of members, those within the service delivery have become jaded and overwhelmed by what has been described as the cluttered landscape. So I do agree with some colleagues who are concerned about merely adding another tier of authority to the landscape is seen in itself as being part of the solution, when indeed it might become part of a future problem. Another step, a rejig, does not answer the questions that were raised by these two reports in 2012. I'm pleased to have heard that the Minister is listening to the comments that he's heard around the chamber. He seems to produce a welcomed approach that says not only will he listen, but we're persuaded he will change the direction to take account, particularly in relation to the definitions that we've discussed, but also about the leadership and governance issues which pertain here. There's one element that we've all avoided, which I think has a particular impact in this whole scene, and that's the filthy money. Activity follows money. Those who are able to control budgets can demand service delivery and ensure that it occurs. And within that budget relationship, one would hope that governance would ensure that someone would be held account for the money that is spent on behalf of the public in trying to resolve some of the issues of reoffending, will be held to account in an effective manner, and we will thereby drive up service delivery and bring people back into active life in our communities. There is confusion out there regarding the links to community planning and to other service delivery plans, and one would hope that the Minister would pay attention to the reservations that have been expressed there. COSLR were good enough to provide a briefing in relation to today's debate, and I trust that the Minister will pay particular attention to the points that they've raised within their briefing paper. There is obviously a sensitivity there about nationally driven plans which do not operate with the effectiveness one would want on the local platform. Finally, I would draw the Minister's attention to the briefing from Bernardo's, who again reiterate the definition in relation to community justice. I agree with some of the comments from the members at the back benches that say our commitment should not begin after the first conviction. It needs to be long before that. We know some of the problems that lead people into the criminal justice system, and once badged, it's hard to escape the pressures that come thereafter. And on that point, I conclude that we support the Minister in his efforts, and we look forward to the amendments that he brings forward at a later stage. Thanks, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And I now call on Paul Wheelhouse to wind up the debate. Minister, you have until just before 5 p.m.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I am very grateful to members for the very thoughtful contributions that they have made across the Chamber to this afternoon's debate. As Graham Pearson indicated in his closing remarks, this bill is very much about reoffending, but I take his point entirely and hope he accepts my words of reassurance in this, that we very much reflect the points about prevention and indeed the need to look beyond the boundaries of the bill to issues such as housing, employment and other support services for individuals to make sure they are supported. And I know Dave Stewart is here. I still regard him very much as a fresh-faced member of this chamber, so don't be so defeatist, Mr Stewart. But I think the input we've had around the chamber from the expertise people who've been involved in social work in the criminal justice system in terms of former police officers and others, I think it shows the value of the Parliament bringing that experience to bear on such an important issue. I am greatly encouraged that the lead committee's endorsement of the bill has been reflected in the debate, and I very much welcome the support from political parties across the chamber for the general principles, and take on board that in some cases is conditional on us working on amendments at stage two. I won't have enough time today to respond to all of the points that members have made, but will no doubt return to a number of them when we consider the detail of the bill at stage two. But I want to turn to as much as I can of the points that have been raised. Firstly, in response to Elaine Murray, who gave a very thoughtful speech and a very considerate one, so I thank her for that. I welcome the local engagement on the national strategy. I want to thank her for her positive remarks and indeed for taking part in that exercise and showing support for it at a local level. I'm sure that will have been appreciated by local stakeholders. And I will have the opportunity, obviously, to see this in person at the next local event in Edinburgh on Tuesday, where I look forward to meeting many stakeholders myself and to hearing directly from them. Most of the material we have dealt with, I think, already, but I would just want to recognise the hard work of the community justice authorities. I know members across the chamber, in reflecting Dame Eilish Angelini's report and drawing attention to perhaps some of the perceived criticisms of the current model, would also want to share my own thoughts in thanking those who are involved with the CGAs in delivering hard work on behalf of us all across our communities and indeed their staff. Prevention has been much of a theme today. Prevention is very much an ethos. Every intervention, support, or management is an opportunity to work with an individual to aid prevention. And I reflect a number of comments from individuals like Nigel Dawe and John Finney. Indeed, sort of, we reflect on this in another debate in another context about the need to take the approach that's maybe taken in terms of Griffith. To a different level for adults to look at how we take a person-centred approach. And indeed, Nigel Dawe and others have referred to the outcomes that we would be developing, that some of them are person-centric, and I think we need to take that approach to look at how we get the solution right for the individual and hopefully prevent them reoffending. The bill does not cover primary prevention. This is dealt with effectively by other Scottish Government policies, with solutions laying primarily outside the justice system, as I referred to. Early years interventions, raising educational attainment, action to tackle youth unemployment, and our policies in health and housing, etc. However, the bill does absolutely cover secondary and tertiary prevention, that is, stopping people reoffending and preventing the escalation of people's offending. The new model for community justice is designed to ensure appropriate, proportionate and effective interventions in response to offending behaviour. The reason why we have not so far taken this further was that we were keen to promote the increased use of diversion community sentences and reduced use of short-term custodial sentences, because we believe the evidence is clear that this is the most effective way to reduce reoffending and prevent further harm to victims, families and communities. But I do take on board the points that have been made across the chamber about looking again at the definition, and just take the opportunity to reiterate that point I made in my opening remarks, but that is very much a live issue. A number of MSPs have mentioned victims, and I think it's entirely right that we do so. I'd like to reassure members that I recognise the importance and value of the voice of victims in community justice. My officials recently met with a range of third sector organisations, including Scottish Women's Aid and Victim Support Scotland, to discuss how best to involve the third sector in planning community justice. So let me reiterate the vital contribution which the third sector is making and will continue to make to community justice, and we will take that forward. Clearly, it's important to stop people entering the criminal justice system in the first place, though, and I take that point entirely from Graham Pearson and others' contributions. That is why government has a clear focus on advancing the whole system approach and improving life chances. And I believe that we have broadly the right approach here. The drive in community justice to reduce reoffending is part of our wider approach to promoting social justice and tackling inequality, which includes action to improve early years and experiences, to raise educational attainment, and to continue to promote the whole system's approach to youth justice. As I said in my opening remarks, a range of other policies are addressing issues such as drugs misuse, which Graham Pearson again referred to, and the new national strategy for community justice will link these other strategies to ensure a joined-up approach. On the definition itself, there's no existing statutory definition of community justice. The translation of our policy into legislation has therefore been taken forward with some care, and any revised wording for Section 1 of the Bill needs to work within the existing legal framework and legislation. The definition of community justice in the Bill sets out the functions and machinery required for the planning, delivery and reporting community justice outcomes, but it is very much a legal definition for the specific purposes of the Bill. On prevention and early intervention, the government has a focus on the whole system approach, a range of other policies, as I mentioned. But that said, I do recognise the definition could be strengthened further. I will explore with stakeholders the possibility of reflecting, for example, the preventative impact of diversionary activity in the definition. And after all, we do know, as I think a number of members have acknowledged, evidence shows that diverting individuals away from criminal justice is an effective way of preventing further offending. Margaret McDougall, Alison McInnes and David Stewart touched on the role of housing. I've referred to it in short terms earlier on, but the national strategy is currently being developed in partnership with a broad range of stakeholders. It would be premature to offer assurances about which topics will be included, but I do recognise the vital role that housing in particular is able to provide in terms of stability. Indeed, I heard that directly from those inmates in Paul McYoung Offenders Institute yesterday, who were saying housing is the very vehicle by which they get stability to get employment. From employment, they get the self-esteem and pride back in their lives, and hopefully the ability to get on the straight and narrow. I certainly will.
Christine Greil.
I wonder if the Minister is aware, and perhaps he is, that in the Project 218 in Glasgow, one of the first things they established for women who were put into prison was to make sure their tenancy was secure. Otherwise, it was automatically taken from them when they were in prison, and that gave them somewhere to come out. So I hope the Minister will translate that into other issues regarding prisoners on release maintaining tenancies.
Indeed, that's an extremely important point. This whole issue is going to be considered as part of the developing the national outcomes and the performance framework. So very much give Christine Graham reassurance. These issues are vital to our way forward. On the resourcing issues, in terms of Scottish Prison Service and transfers to community, as we see the impact of preventative work, what happens in this context, while it is a separate process, it is implicit within our proposals for strengthening the presumption against shorter sentences, indeed for a wider penal policy and community justice reforms, that we expect to see a shift in resources from prisons to community-based services. Annabel Goldie seemed to take, I think, the wrong impression from the letter I sent to the committee. That was indeed in response to a direct question to me from the committee that I address perhaps the perception the bill wasn't addressing the possibility of changes resulting from a presumption against short sentences consultation, taking the outcome that the government is obviously taking forward. So I hope it reassures it wasn't something that was done willfully, but in response to a question from the Justice Committee, to give reassurance that the model is flexible enough to adapt to any changes that come downstream, including reforms to the women's custodial estate as well. We have already seen a shift taking place with £1.5 million transferred from SPS to invest in community-based justice services for women and work by Scottish Prison Service to transform its role. For example, with reference to through care and other services to help people leaving prison integrate back into the community. I want to take some of the time I have left, Presiding Officer, to reflect on the third sector more, including organisations which support victims and families, as I mentioned earlier. It is vital to the successful planning and delivery of effective and efficient services for individuals. The sector, as a number of members have mentioned, delivers about a third of the community justice activity we already see in Scotland. It already has a vital role and has made a long-standing contribution to the delivery of outcomes for community justice at a national level. Rod Campbell was quite correct to refer to Section 18 of the Bill, which requires community justice partners to consult and enable the participation of the third sector in the planning of services and improved outcomes for community justice. However, I have listened to concerns from the third sector. I am now exploring how we might amend the provisions to strengthen their role and participation. Third sector bodies have a different legal status and different lines of accountability as compared with public bodies listed at Section 12 of the Bill as community justice partners. There may be difficulties if Parliament sought to impose statutory duties of this type on bodies such as charities, and accordingly they've not been included to date as statutory community justice partners. But I do take the board the point, as made by Margaret McDougall and others, that we need to reflect them more fully in this, and I give a commitment that we are doing so. On commissioning, this is another important area for third sector organisations. Community Justice Scotland's first actions will be to work with partners and the third sector, both purchasers and providers of services, to develop and agree a strategic approach to commissioning. This will ensure an evidence-led and coordinated long-term approach to commissioning for community justice in Scotland. And the intention is the third sector will be an equal partner in the process of agreeing the strategic approach to commissioning itself. On the issue of short-term funding and the longevity of it, we very much recognise the constraints and uncertainty that one-year funding creates, particularly around the strategic commissioning of services. Presiding Officer, short-term funding is an issue that goes wider than community justice, indeed wider than Scottish Government. And within the gift we have for community justice, Section 27 funding for criminal justice social work has been protected year on year in the face of significant cuts from the UK Government. But the Scottish Government has provided ring-fence funding of more than £750 million since 2008-09. The Funding Technical Advisory Group has been established to consider the work of developing a new formula for Section 27 funding to replace the current model. A move from annual system of funding to a funding model over a three-year period is one of the issues being considered by the group. The advisory group are due to report to the main funding group in the last quarter of this year. Post discussion between Scottish Government and COSLA, recommendations will then be made to the joint Scottish Government and COSLA settlement and distribution group, and the new funding model will go live in 2017-2018. Presiding Officer, I see time is against me. I would just want to reiterate the points that I have made, that members have contributed very strongly to this debate, and finish by saying the new National Outcome Performance and Improvement Framework will address a number of the points raised by members, including John Finney, Elaine Murray, Gil Paterson and Nigel Dawn, about taking a person-centric approach and developing outcomes and indicators that will improve the delivery of community justice in Scotland. But time is against me, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much to all members in the Chamber, and I look forward to working with them as we take the bill forward.
That concludes the Stage 1 debate on the Community Justice Scotland Bill. The next item of business is consideration of motion number 14805 in the name of John Swinney on the financial resolution for the Community Justice Scotland Bill. I call on John Swinney to move the motion. Deputy First Minister.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Question: this motion will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The next question is that motion number 14879 in the name of Paul Wheelhouse on Community Justice Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14805 in the name of John Swinney on the financial resolution for the Community Justice Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed to. Can I just remind members, if you need reminded, that the Book of Condolence is in the main hall for those who suffered in the Paris attacks. If you have not yet signed it and wish to do so, please do so now, because the book will be removed tomorrow. So this is about your last opportunity. That concludes decision time. I now close this